first one that had it.
Did you get rained on tonight?
I don't think I got rained on.
Did you see the sky right before the sun went down? It's like totally black in the east.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm going to sit in a candlelit kitchen. It's going to be with my own family. Thank you very much.
Not with help?
Oh, that's funny.
He actually said, well, I'd meet you out in one of the downtown was open.
Conservation Krishna live. Thank you.
We're live?
We're live.
Jamie, do you need the mics? Yeah, mics charging?
I'm trying to find it. Break. Yeah, but I'll break. Take it anyway. Thank you.
I don't, actually.
Oh, it's right in front of me. No, it's not. Which should I recycle?
You can.
This one?
Yes.
Okay. I'd like to bring the Conservation Commission meeting to order. And first on the agenda is a continued request for determination of applicability for the Hawley property, RDA 2016-02, 213 Charles Street. And Mr. Hawley? I believe at the last meeting we had requested information from an arborist. This project is the cutting of trees in the backyard, and we received something today. Did you have a chance to look?
I looked at the letter or the memo or the document from Northeast Tree, dated 27 January. Dated today.
So I had a chance to review the letter. The first tree that that was discussed in it was the large pine that we all kind of talked about quite a bit. It's outside of the.
Did you say?
My recollection is outside the 50-foot. buffer.
Let's see.
I have to refresh myself.
So, are all these trees they're talking about? I'm sorry, I have not made the site visit. Are all the trees they're talking about roughly the same size?
This particular tree is ginormous. It's about 100 and what? Plus?
110, 120.
It's that one, and then
is the is the
these trees said it was about 160. Just so you know.
Okay. And so the diameter is approaching 3 feet?
32 inches, I think he said it was. It's a big one.
Yeah. It was tall.
Yeah. And then there were three pine trees along this side. The one in the middle was dead. And those are what he's talking
mm-hmm.
about right
mm-hmm.
there.
There were three other trees originally that I think was proposed.
Yes, we came to an agreement of leaving those other three and
okay.
just talking about
these four.
Four.
Okay,
yes.
Great.
And the reason for wanting to remove them?
The big one in the middle is a hazard to my house, I feel. It's a very big tree, and if it goes, it's going to ruin my house, my neighbors. And the one, the three in the back, the one in the middle, it's termite damaged. And part of the reason that I was asked to get the letter from an arborist was we were worried about, I was worried about the other two on either side being compromised by that one coming out in the middle, seeing as that they're so close together.
So just to, if I can jump in. So some of the comments made on the letter from Northeast Tree about the large pine tree in the center of the yard is that it has, there's an open cavity on the right side of the tree. And there's a double leader in the tree. You know, these are observations about the relative integrity of the tree. Was there an explicit statement by the arborist that he thought the tree should go?
It was a woman.
Okay.
She had stated that because of that cavity.
Arborist.
I'm not an arborist. I'm just trying, because of that cavity that water and dirt and stuff can get in there, which kills mm-hmm. the tree. And her concern with the two that are intertwined is those have a tendency to sway off either way, depending on which way the wind blows. And it's just more, if you looked at the tree, the cavity that's there would have went to the right, and the other two that are intertwined go off to the left. So there's kind of like an imbalance there, if I might say.
I see.
If these four trees are taken, will there be any remaining white pines on the property?
Oh, yes. There's another big one on the right side of my property that I had said that I would be willing to keep, and there were two others in the back. Yes, there are.
The arborist makes a point that we see often in Reading that if you start to chop down white pine trees from a group, those that remaining become isolated and they then become compromised. So I think if we do allow, in my opinion, removal of these trees, that we plant some more trees near some existing trees to try and recreate a new cluster. And if you take care of them, those white pines can grow relatively quickly so we can have a mature stand in 4 or 5 years.
I think we have been talking about replacement.
Good.
These trees, in particular this one, stands alone. There's grass behind it. This kind of is the tree line. So most of the tree, and the wetland in back next to the shed. Mm-hmm. So I think, and I think these three, Mr. Hawley, if I'm correct,
yes.
Those stand alone too, don't they?
Correct, yes.
Yes, okay.
It's kind of like, there's actually an old stump, which is probably just as big as that tree in the middle, that was right near them, but the stump is still there. It's just, mm-hmm. you know, there's like a little hill there. And it was just right. Those three and nothing else really around them.
So I think we would ask for some kind of replacement trees. Chuck Taroni has a list of native species that might be appropriate.
I would suggest white pine.
Just to intervene with that, I was talking to someone about replanting some white pines, and they said that they won't take in that conservation soil in the back. I will do it, but I just don't want to put something there that is not going to work.
Well, white pines are facultative. They will grow in damp soils. They won't. Can't stand extended periods of submergence, but you'll see white pines on the upland ends of wetlands all the time. I mean, they're there now.
Was that your arborist that
No, it was a gentleman I work with who runs the Fresh Pond Reservation where I work.
I would plant them just on the, can't tell the directions there, but on the opposite side of the existing trees from the house. In other words, a little bit farther from the house, but in approximately same location as the existing trees would be my suggestion. Because if that, the soils were supported that tree for 160 feet, about 120 years, I think it's probably pretty good soil for white pine.
Chuck, do you have any comments?
No, I think it's a good idea that you plant some white pines. I'm not, and you can look at the board here and see the only spot to put the cluster together would be on the right-hand side, looking towards the back of the house. I believe he's taken everything out on the left-hand side. So the one that's 84 feet away, 86 feet away, 91 feet away, and 57 feet away are all, those are the ones we're talking about. So they're gone. That black line with the X's through it is approximately where the break and slope and the wetland starts, further back. So it needs to be upgrading of that line. So maybe planting in this area here.
Are there already some pines there?
I believe that's a pine.
Because I think
everything else is a pine besides the one that's the 87 foot, and I think we had said that was a maple.
There's a swamp maple in there, 87 feet, is that
there?
Yeah.
Okay. Remember we, there was sort of like a dead branch, I think.
The swamp maple is back, so.
I would.
So that one at 87 feet is a pine or maple?
It's a maple, swamp maple.
How about the one at 92 feet?
Pine.
Must be a pine.
And that is not coming out, correct?
No.
Why don't we plant them near that one that's 92 feet away? Just up gradient of that one that's 92 feet. Create a little cluster right in there.
This is where that tree is at 87 feet.
Mm-hmm.
There is a significant slope going down.
Right.
I mean,
so
I can plant it in that flat area.
Yeah, in the flat area. Just
skunk
the
cabbage,
the
I think it is. Is that what it's called?
The flower skunk cabbage?
Yeah, like where that's
there.
That
the
is.
The uphill side of that slope.
The uphill
right.
side
right.
of that slope.
Okay.
And if it's, you know, if it's 80 feet from the house, we won't be around if it gets too tall to damage the house, I can tell you. Or at least I won't. Maybe some of you younger people will, but I won't.
It'll take a while. Are you folks all set?
How many replacement trees are you asking for?
This is it. Have we been doing one to one?
I think maybe one for the smaller ones, but two for that giant.
Okay.
So four.
Four.
And let's go with ones that are 4 to 6 feet tall would
what?
Be my suggestion.
You say four?
Yeah. I think that is one for one.
That's not
that would be one for one. You need five.
Well,
as
one of
five.
Them's dead.
Oh, yeah.
One of them's dead.
Southern path going on.
We're not counting the dead one.
All right.
Yeah. And I would suggest trees that are 4 to 6 feet tall. Be my suggestion.
Just 4 to 6 feet? 3-inch caliper, 12 to 15 inch, fill it 15 feet.
15?
No. Wouldn't you do that? 4 to 6 feet is kind of.
Well, I'm open. I mean, if, whatever you think, but I wouldn't want anything. I wouldn't want those little 2-foot ones that you buy at Home Depot. But other than that, I'm certainly amenable to the consensus with the group. A 15-foot pine is going
to
be
six to 8 feet.
A 15-foot pine is going to cost you about $100, maybe a little more. 6 to 8. If you shop around, you can get one for $30, $40.
You know, for me, it's I think we should have something that when it's planted, it's got a really good chance of thriving.
Yeah.
You know, and so maybe a slightly more mature tree.
Actually, that'd be the opposite.
Yeah,
it's they have a better chance when they're
younger,
yeah. smaller,
to adapt.
Yeah, because you're talking about a root system that has to get
okay.
established.
The problem with those little ones, though,
You don't want.
Somebody steps on them, they get damaged, or a top breaks off, and then there's not enough foliage left.
Four to six, we were talking about 4 to 6 feet.
4 to 6.
I'm good with that.
Sounds fine to me.
You know, and we will put in, one of the conditions we typically put in is that it must, you know, survive. You know, or if it doesn't survive, it has to be replaced.
Okay.
You know, that we want to see these put in there and stay.
Stable.
Yeah.
So are we all set?
Yeah, so I move we issue.
No, I need to ask the public if they have any issues or comments. And if you do, please identify yourself, where you live. Hearing none, do I hear a motion?
I move we issue a negative determination for 213 Charles Street for the removal of 3 live and 1 dead white pine tree with the conditions for replacement as discussed.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank
Chuck,
you.
Chuck, so when does he get, will he get his negative determination?
Yeah, he'll get a negative determination. I prepared this. I don't have
the amended
material in it, but if you could sign it, I could send it out after I change up.
And is there an appeal period?
Oh,
there's a 10-day appeal period.
Is there anything that we didn't talk about stump grinding?
No, we didn't.
They're planning on being ground out.
We grind out those stumps there at the toe of the slope. That just destabilizes the soils.
This one is not at the toe of the slope.
Oh, it's the...
The other side where the slope is, those trees are staying.
Oh, okay.
So the way the yard works, you can kind of see where it's coming in here. It really makes a turn in this area.
So that 91 foot is really kind of at the top of the slope. Is that it?
Where those the three clusters, there's actually a little hill there.
Yeah.
That they're built
yeah.
on. Yeah, so
so
yeah.
it's not at the bottom of the slope.
Yeah, I think it's at the top. I think there's actually a little bit more room too, if I recall.
Okay.
Well, if he does grind the slope, then we need to make sure the soils are stabilized and something planted right away. So if you could add that too, Chuck.
Planted right away?
Or
not in this season?
No, but I said stabilized, and then once we can, something planted.
Okay. Would you like some explanation on that, or does that?
I have no problem. My question is, where am I going to put these new trees? Has that been determined? Or is it wherever I want? I mean, I'm just asking. I don't know if there's some place you'd rather see them.
See where the, I guess somewhere in between the 56 and the 87 foot above or on the upland side of the break and slope.
Could I go straight back, follow that yellow line from the 56 foot in line? Like up against my, yeah, like right up, yeah.
Yeah, but they need to be in close proximity to some existing white pine.
Well, that 56 footer is a white pine.
Okay, good.
I mean,
give that one some protection anyway.
Yeah, good. That'll work for me.
It'll be easier for me to take care of them too, because, you know, the yacht's pretty deep. Now, I mean, as far as the stump grinding goes, would you rather the stumps be removed? I mean,
I'll just voice my own personal opinion and let other people chime in if they think differently. If you want to leave, if you're okay aesthetically with leaving a little bit of a stump and saving the grinding, I don't see, from a conservation perspective, I don't see a value to grinding. You know, so if anything, we have asked some people to leave like some sort of stand for the dead tree, which becomes a habitat for woodpeckers and other species, and it's some sort of stand of like 5 or 10 feet that, you know, doesn't pose a risk to your property if it does fall, you know what I mean? So, you know, the only thing I have to say about that is agree that, you know, if the stump does get ground and the soil does get disturbed, that all of a sudden becomes a conservation concern. You know, we don't want to see soil eroding down into the wetland. You know, so, and it might save you some cost, if, you know, if you could stand to have a couple stumps in the back, you know, that's fine with me.
Yeah, I would second that. If I prefer that you didn't rock them, that you left the stump there.
But it you know, it's...
But we're not requiring that you do that.
Okay. I mean, just there's one more thing, where the cluster of three trees are, the wetland is back further than from on the other side of the yard. It kind of goes in that, just so, I mean, I don't think there'd be a disturbance.
I think that that big pine tree is in the center of his yard. Of course, he wants to grind that down. He wants a yard.
That makes sense.
Okay.
Yeah. That one's not an issue.
Those three over there, usually you get a little, you're worried about the slope stabilization when you're pulling out the entire root. But grinding them down doesn't destabilize the slope.
What
well,
about
as
the
much.
Machinery? What about the machinery?
Well, they only grind them down about 2 inches below the surface. Right. I mean, it's not really. If they can cut them flush,
right.
So think about that, and then take 2 more inches off. What's the difference? You just have a little bit of dirt on top.
Right.
So, usually, cutting them flush or grinding them is considered the same.
Yeah.
So they're not going 2 feet down.
Yeah. Just as long as it isn't, you know, in the wetland.
Okay.
I've seen holes where they grind stumps that are
you work
more
on
significant than 2 inches.
You work on the big jobs.
Give a male a mechanical tool and he's going to take
he'll take it as far into the ground as he can.
It's a genetic.
No comment. Okay.
When you have those trees planted or you have a spot for them, when you have the trees down. And if you're going to ground them or not, just have me come out after that's done to take a look. And then when you plant the trees, or if you want to talk about where they should go, I could help you with that and come out after they're planted.
So am I going to receive any paperwork or any meeting?
Yes, you'll have that by Monday. You could come in tomorrow and pick it up, or I could send it out to you in the mail. You'll have it by Monday.
So your plan is to do it in the next couple of weeks?
Cost pending. And then we know it'll give me a price. You know, it's the big tree is going to be a pretty penny, let's put it that way. Because it has to be craned over my house. So,
right.
After this, I am going to start getting prices. But sooner than later, yes. But I understand that the planting of the new trees is probably going to have to wait until springtime.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Do you have any other questions?
No. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming out.
Sorry it took 2 weeks.
Okay. Next on the agenda is a notice of intent for the Roche property at 20 Dean Road. Notice of intent 270-0654. And this is a...
Do you want to mention...
No, we talked to them already.
Okay.
A few of them.
Sorry.
So I will read the hearing script. Public hearing for the Roche property at 20 Dean Road, DEP number 270-0654, which is, let's see if this one, is a proposed pool, patio, and cutting of trees adjacent to the proposed structures is now opened and is being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant presents the proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrators, technical advisors, and other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, and those questions should be directed to the chair, and when you do that, please give your name and address before your comments or questions are presented. At this time, would the members of the CONCOM, Conservation Commission, please introduce themselves, starting on my left.
Chuck Troney, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chairman.
Janie Moore.
Julie Roger, Recording Secretary.
And I believe we have the applicant's representative.
Yes. For the record, my name is Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. And the owner of the property is seated three rows behind me, but Alan is here tonight as well. What Alan's basically looking to do is to construct an in-ground pool with a surrounding patio that would be constructed with pavers. It would allow water to move through it. He's looking to construct a pool cabana over in this area. He's also looking to construct a small landscaped retaining wall that's about 2 feet high, so that coming off this patio area, there'd be a fence surrounding the enclosed pool area, and then he'd just like to have this small wall here. There would be a stone wall with a 6-inch crushed stone base for his property. Additionally, he'd like to remove some trees. I think a few members of the commission went on the sidewalk. There's some dead trees that have been noted on the plan to come down. A few of the trees do fall within the 25-foot no disturbance zone, so I'm sure we'll have some discussion on that. But I marked the selected trees that he'd like to remove that are within the 100-foot buffer zone for the wetlands. I should note that the wetland line was flagged by Norris Environmental Services. The limit of work line is the 25-foot no disturbance zone. I'm proposing a 12-inch diameter mulch sock, which would be like a compost sock for this project. And there's very limited site grading changes. The pool's going in basically at the existing grade of the backyard. You can see off the back side of the pool, I have a proposed 102 contour just to match in with the existing grade. But you can see on this, I'm basically matching into the existing site grades. One thing that should be noted, back in November, the town, at town meeting, required any accessory structures to be at least 10 feet from the primary structure. So you'll see I have 12 and a half feet from the deck. Even from the pool to the cabana, I'm 13 feet, but I'm required to have 10 feet. So this project meets zoning compliance from the town of Reading. But that's part of the reason we situated the pool where we're situating it. The construction entrance will be over an existing paved driveway. I did show a proposed soil stockpile area here, though. The reality is when they dig the pool, they'll probably remove any material right into a truck, but I did want to show an area where soil would be stockpiled if needed. The pool mechanicals will be located right behind the cabana. And this pool will be a non-backwash pool. It will be a cartridge system. Typically, if you have a backwash system, I would have put some sort of dry well in for backwash use since it's so close. But this is more of an environmentally friendly type pool where you just change out the cartridges and you're not required to backwash. As I stated, there'd be a 4-foot high aluminum fence surrounding the pool as well with a gate to move in and out on. I did receive an email from one neighbor who asked for copies of materials at 141 Eastway. I did provide those the same day I was asked for the materials. I didn't get any feedback. If they're here tonight, I'll gladly try to answer any questions. But I think one of the main concerns is the patio. It's not going to be a poured concrete patio, stamped concrete. It will be pavers to allow water to move through it. The pool is about 600 square feet in area. And typically, what I typically do is off the edge of patios, if it was a surface that would not allow water to move through it, I'd put some sort of drip trench around it. Alan's stated that he'd be fine putting some sort of crushed stone drip trench along the back edge of the pool. And
when you say the back edge, what do you mean?
The back edge towards the wetland line. But the pavers should allow water to move through it. It's not in a an impervious surface. But
the pool is outside the 35-foot no structure zone. There will be some, but like I stated, the limit of work rides right up to the 25-foot no disturbance.
Would you mind repeating what you said about the grading?
Yep. So what we tried to do is we worked with the pool company to try to locate this pool with as little site disturbance as possible. So you can see I have a proposed elevation of 102.5 on the pool. There's an existing 102 contour that runs along this back mm-hmm. side here. And right here I have a proposed contour of 102. So I'm basically matching into the grade. Even over here, we're raising the grade by about 18 inches off the patio, and that's what necessitates. He could just have a landscape slope, but we just want to do a small 2 foot high landscape wall in that area.
So there'll be no grading down slope of your proposed modification of the 102 contour?
That's correct. And you can see there's like an existing spot grade of 102.38.
Right.
And so what we really tried to do is match into the existing grades. So even though, you know, looks like a lot going on within 100 feet, we're trying to really work with the existing grades. There'll be no, if there's any grading between the 35-foot and the 25-foot, it would be very minor.
And what's that circle of?
That's existing.
That's existing.
That's an existing above ground pool?
No, there's an existing, like, it's rocks, like a raised rock garden. It's loose stone walls, and he has some plantings.
And that's going to be demolished?
That'll be gone.
Can I ask a couple more questions?
Sure.
What do you say, proposed 4 foot high aluminum fence?
Yeah.
What does that look like? What? Is it solid?
No, it's not solid. It's 4 feet high. It's open. It's
chain link.
Oh, it's chain link fence.
Would you do want to do chain link, Alan?
Just a black chain link.
Okay.
Okay. And that tree line shown on the drawing, is that actually a tree line or is that just shrubs and
it's a tree line.
So the fence is going within the tree line, within the woods.
Correct.
But you don't have to remove any trees to put that fence in.
What I did is I tried to locate the any trees over 6 inches in diameter. So there is the canopy.
I see one
from
or
these,
two.
See these three here being removed. These trees are being removed.
Are they being removed because of the fence? Or that wall, or why are they being removed?
The owner wanted them to be removed.
We could talk about those.
Yeah, we did a site visit, and do you want to talk about that, Mike?
So there's a lot of trees on this list. Those three in particular, they have several limbs that have fallen. They're all some discussion about what leaning is, but yeah, the 20 inch to the right is leaning basically right over the pool. The 24 inch is leaning pretty excessively towards the house. And I don't really recall, and I don't think we have any notes about the 24 inch. I don't remember the, or 22 inch, I'm sorry, on the left there. But
Do we know, are they deciduous?
The
red
oaks. Three oaks.
They're red oaks. They're all red oaks.
Right.
But healthy, as far as you can tell. It's hard to tell this time of year.
You know.
But no obvious decay or.
There were limbs that were falling off that I, and one of them was definitely leaning towards the house. Is this something where we would want an arborist report? Like we're kind of leaning towards that these days.
I think this is the similar case that we've come across. You know, it's
because what we find, we've been kind of going back and forth with the applicant on the site. Well, would you consider leaving this? Because there were some healthy trees in back. One, a 12-inch white pine. The other two, the 10-inch and the 18-inch, were I think they were cedars and they were dead. We could understand that, but
there's several in here that are marked down that are just, from what we could tell, are just dead.
But some don't appear to be. And then there were others that were marked down for removal, for instance, a 2-inch peach tree that he just wants to relocate. He doesn't want to remove.
Actually,
yeah.
In addition, so different from the plan, I believe the 2 28-inch
They're white pines, yes.
Yeah,
right here.
The applicant had indicated that he didn't actually want to have those removed.
Okay.
And they're healthy and they wouldn't compromise the house.
Yeah.
They're kind of down on a slope,
yeah,
in the tree line.
And there was one additional tree that's not shown here, which was a 6-inch
birch.
And where's that located?
It was about halfway between the.
I see.
It was
right here.
Okay, so kind of downhill, just across the dark dashed line from the circle.
Correct, just inside the 25.
Okay. Is there a tree that's being taken out that's not identified in the center of that circle?
It's going to get moved. It's in a Japanese name.
There isn't.
Oh, okay.
Chuck, do you have I
think we have some information here, but I think I'd like to see a little bit more detailed listing of what's staying, what's moving, what's going, and if trees are being removed, what's the health of that tree, and what is it an arborist's opinion that it needs to come down?
Good point. Chuck, did you have some additional
information that we were looking
requests for information?
Yeah, I had sent Jack a request on the 14th to just provide some more information. Test pits, field data sheets, some imperviousness mitigation.
I know you touched on the impervious mitigation.
For the wetland line.
We might like to see on a plan.
Sure.
Like a detail on the retaining wall?
Right.
Auger. You mean, or do you mean...
Not augering, but...
And put it in a test pit.
Well, you auger the line, but you have to have a test pit, and we wanted to know where that was.
For the wall?
No, for the wetland line, for the
soil probes.
So,
which I had,
but nothing for the wall. No test pit. I'm not asking for test pits for any other spot, unless this commission wants them. That fieldstone retaining wall is just on 6 inches of compacted, you know, gravel. So I don't know about that. So, anyways, there was a few things. The distance between the wetland and the proposed work, which I thought was missing off the plan. All these things. Just make a better plan and easy to talk about, but we do have some additional requests at this point. It sounds like you've been asked for an arborist to go out and evaluate the trees. When I was there was one that was extremely healthy but leaning and stretching for the sun is what I think was what I said. But it was leaning a lot, but if you did talk to an arborist, maybe a plan could be come up where not so many leaves get into the pool in the fall, but we're limbing also and cutting where we have to instead of just wholesale cutting.
Which I think Alan and I spoke before the meeting, and that was something you were open to, right, Alan?
Mm-hmm.
One other question I have about the plan is, so the cabana, is that going to have a foundation? Is it going to have utilities? How are those going to get to the house?
It would have a foundation, but no, other than electric. And then it would be propane.
Did you say it would not have a foundation?
No, it would.
What is
so
the...
So like a slab or a...
That would have to be a slab.
Okay.
Not a dug.
It's better not to. I can put it... You can do it another way.
Just need to know.
Okay. Right now it's a slab.
Yeah.
So that would just be typical 4-inch slab, compacted soil, stuff like that. Okay.
Just want to know for the sake of digging in that area and what's going to happen with soil there.
So, and that brings up, we asked for the detail on the wall and maybe the slab also. Be simple enough.
Will the slab be the floor of the cabana?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
I know you, I appreciate you putting the proposed stockpile area on the plan, just to put it in there. How much soil would be generated? I'd love to see that soil stockpile maybe temporarily move to the front of the house, and not down slope of the work area in the back of the house.
Yeah, I tried to pick an area where wherever we stockpiled the soil, that area is going to get disturbed and have to be re-landscaped, so I was trying to avoid having to do that out front. I actually was thinking,
right.
Oh, I could take a portion of his driveway, put it over that, but, you know, he has a two-car garage and trying to back in and out is a problem, so
right.
I appreciate what you're saying. I could do something in the front, but then it would just, if it gets destroyed, he'd have to spend more money to fix it up, and I figured
but
that area would
already get. I think you said, and it's been my experience too, they did go swimming pools, they just go right from the backhoe or the excavator into the truck.
That's what I think they're going to do.
That's every time I've seen it done, it's been done that way.
Right.
I said to Jack too, if it has to go in the driveway, that's fine. It's not.
I mean, he doesn't want to move that soil twice. Because eventually we'll be hauled off site, correct?
Yes.
Right.
They usually
right.
just haul it right back.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
I would say the order of conditions says it's hauled off site, and if contractor isn't willing to do that, you can come back to us and use the proposed area. But that would be my preference, and I think that the contractor would want to do it that way too.
Yeah.
Any further questions from the commission?
Yeah, I just wanted to finish off a couple of things. Usually when someone's putting a pool in town, I ask them to provide a seasonal maintenance plan. So I know that you're using a cartridge system. It might be a little different, but still, if you could provide that and some information just to tell us what's happening every winter and every spring. And then we usually don't allow silt socks for work of this magnitude, so I'm going to ask that you use hay bale and silt fence.
Okay.
Are there any questions from the public? Hearing none, do I hear a motion to continue?
Before we do, I'm not clear on what we're doing with the trees. We're asking for a
arborist
report.
Right.
Well, we want a better plan. Maybe the arborist can suggest limbing up some of the trees and removing the ones that must be removed. So the commission isn't accepting to take down all the trees.
Right. And in light of the last arborist report, I think somebody raised a good question. We should specifically ask the arborist to state what the risk is, or the consequences are of leaving the trees, and if they, if they have a recommendation to remove it because it's dangerous to the house or the pool, or what is their conclusion?
I think that's fair, and the plan needs to reflect, you know, some of the conversations we've had about saving some of the trees, you know, and removing other ones, and not replacement, but relocating.
Whether it's relocated, if it's not going to be taken out, let's take it off the plan. And if there's one, you know, I think we only counted one, but if there's something shown that will be removed, let's get it on the plan and identify it.
And if you were to propose replacement for trees you're taking, that would give us a place to start.
Yeah.
That's not a problem either.
Yeah.
My preference is not to take trees down. Our lot is beautiful with the trees. The obvious ones, which are dead.
Right.
I mean, it's a no-brainer on those. The oaks, I would love to keep, but they are just really leaning over where the pool will be.
An arborist might be able to help us out there.
Yeah. And that's why we talked about, like, all the options of it. And
so when we are talking about dead trees removed, we're not looking for a replacement, is that correct?
That's fine, but I would like to leave a four-foot stump if we can.
That's
okay.
could think a couple of them are diseased, so, you know, I would just want to cut below where the diseased part is.
Yeah.
It was the black cherries had some stuff going on there. And then the cedars, something's come through and killed all the cedars.
Yeah, I don't. We don't need to leave those stumps.
But, you know, that's fine with the 4 foot or 6 foot. So it's really, it's just that the oaks that are the big question.
Yep.
So I make a motion to continue.
A second.
All those in favor?
On what date?
Well, let me ask the commission.
Didn't ask the public for any time.
Oh, yes, I did.
Yeah, we did.
Oh, did we? Okay.
Yes, I did.
All those people, nobody wants to comment?
The next scheduled meeting would be the 10th of February, but I will not be able to attend.
I won't be here.
I'm not able to attend either.
So we don't have a quorum. Therefore, the next meeting would be February 24th. So it'll be continued to the 24th. I just want everybody to know that right up front. Okay. Okay. All right. Thank you.
So it's been seconded. Did we vote?
No, we didn't vote.
Oh, we didn't vote.
No.
All those in favor?
Thank you
very much.
Yep. Thank you.
Okay. Next on the agenda is another notice of intent. The public hearing for La Tondra at 240 Grove Street, DEP number 270-0655.
She's got them.
Is tree removal and actually work addition, I think, in the back outside of the 100-foot buffer zone. Is now opened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing will be conducted in the following manner. Applicant presents proposal. Commission receives reports from the administrator, advisors, and other departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. And then when you do that, give your name and address before your comments or questions are presented. At this time, with the members of the CONCOM, Conservation Commission, introduce themselves, starting on my right.
Julie Roger, Recording Secretary.
Jamie Moore.
Rebecca Longley, Chairman.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Michael Flynn.
Chuck Tarone, Conservation Administrator.
And would the applicant or the applicant's representative?
My name is Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group, and I'm here tonight with the owners, Jeff Nanny, and I also have an arborist with me here, Bob Moses. Jeff and Annie recently purchased this property, and they're looking to renovate the existing home. And the good news with this project is the majority of the work is basically just landscaping and some tree removal within 100 feet to the wetland line. Again, Norse Environmental flagged the wetlands for us. It's very well defined because of the steep slope off of the rear of the lot. You can see where the 100-foot buffer zone falls, and they're basically looking to take down looks like 6 trees within the 100-foot buffer zone. The closest tree to the wetland is probably a good 80 feet away. Five of the 6 trees are hardwood trees, one's a pine tree, and there will be some limited site grading as well, transitional grading. Where they're looking to put the addition on the house, it's outside the conservation's jurisdiction, but what we try to do with this addition is match pretty closely to the existing grade here. You can see there's an existing grade at 215, 17 here. I'm at 214, 58, and there's an existing 214 contour here. So it gives a relatively flat rear yard in this area. It's over in this section where I'd look to try to level the yard out somewhat to give them somewhat of a level backyard for a portion of their rear yard. And then it steps off at a 3-to-1 slope, which is pretty consistent with the existing slope on the rear slope anyways of this property. They are looking to take down some other trees as well in the yard, but they're all outside the 100-foot buffer zone. They can do that by right. And I have Bob Moses here if there's any questions on the tree removal, but it's a pretty straightforward project. I am proposing a 12-inch diameter mulch sock again. We put in any type of erosion control. It's just most of the towns now like the mulch socks because at the end of the job, you can just rip them open, spread the compost or mulch, and there's no removal of hay bales or anything, and they seem to work pretty well. But we're open to any sort of input you might have. Turn it over to the commission for any questions.
So have you only shown the trees that you're removing within the buffer zone? I see one 10-inch that doesn't have an X through it, so I assume that's not going to be removed.
That's staying.
So that means there'll only be one tree left?
No, there's other trees on the slope. But when I did the survey work, I went out, I wasn't sure what Jeff and Annie wanted to take down for trees. So I located a number of the trees, but I didn't locate every tree within the 100-foot buffer zone. It is wooded.
Yes. So Jamie, we performed a site visit yesterday, and within the what I guess we call the erosion control line, and up from the house, those are all basically all the marked trees. But once you get past that, it's a pretty steep slope. There's vegetation, trees all along that slope. It's about, you can tell from the contours, it's about a 20 to 30 foot slope. So
the reason I located the 34-inch pine, because I originally we had talked about maybe taking that one down, but we're leaving it.
Oh, you are leaving it?
Yes.
The ones with the crosses. It's hard to see.
It's
with the
hard
pines.
To see, but
well, the 30.
This one's staying. This 34-inch pine staying. It is hard to see, but this one's coming out. This one coming out. This one coming out. And these three here. So one's right at the 100-foot line. There's two 8-inch trees just inside.
And why are those two 8-inch trees or three 8-inch trees being removed because of the grading?
Because of the
yes.
grading? I think mostly because of the grading, yeah.
And how about the 30 and the 22 and 28? Why are they being removed?
Could the arborist talk about this? He actually explained this to us pretty
succinctly
when we were out.
You have a better answer than I do.
My name's Bob Moses. I'm a Mass Arborist. My company is Arbor Tree Service. And I had the opportunity to perform a site visit with three of the folks from the committee, Rebecca and Charles and Michael. And the three trees that are in question, if we start at the far right, which is that 28-inch red oak, which incidentally, just for the record, and I pulled the tape down to the beginning of the delineation, and that tree was actually at 121 feet. So to me, it was a question on whether it was actually within that 100-foot buffer zone, and I did take pictures of that, and I showed these folks while we were there. But that particular tree has up at, following the trunk, and I actually have a photo of it, but following the trunk up to where the 2 liters Y out, it has what's called an included or common bark crotch. And what happens with included or common bark crotches is where the two crotches meet, there's actually no bark in between. And over the years, leaves fall in that crotch and they settle and they actually compost in that crotch and they create, which is a shear crack. And I can pass this around so you can see what it looks like. I was able to point it out to these guys when I was there. Actually, that's one that's in my phone. I'll have to show you. If you don't mind, can I approach?
Mm-hmm.
So this here is that tree where it trunks out,
mm-hmm.
and you can see the crack, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And that crack is evident on both sides of the tree, all right, where those 2 liters meet, see it?
Is it possible to remove one leader and the
no.
other leader to?
Agricultural standards, 25% of food storage in one growth season. If you took out half of this, you'd be taking out about 60%. So it's really not good common practice. Plus, I did take a picture of that particular tree with the proximity to where the house is, and that tree is approximately 20 feet from where the existing house is. I'm sure I should show the photos. But here's the crack in the trunks.
That's all right. I know what you're speaking about, Annie.
So you can see the crack right there.
Yep.
And these guys saw it when
yes.
we were there.
Yep.
So that is definitely an issue. When I go to job sites and look at work, I always, 95% of storm damage, wind damage failures are at that corner bar crotch. And that tree is totally leaning towards the house. Now, the other one in the middle, which is an eastern white pine.
That's at 30 inch?
22.
22 inch pine.
22 inch.
It's hard to see the cross.
So 22, you're not taking.
They are.
Oh, they are.
He is, and that's
yes.
what he's going to talk about now.
Okay.
And you can see the evidence of boring insects, most commonly sawflies, which get into the white pines, and it's around the entire tree. Now those compromise the structural integrity of the heartwood of the tree. Again, it's very close to the new construction of the property, so that also was recommended. And then the third tree, which is the left side red oak, had some horizontal cracking in the bark, which would be evident of some structural integrity damage in the heart of the tree. Also, again, these trees are all very close to the house. One of the folks asked me about the erosion issue, if this could cause a problem with erosion, and I did take a picture of a levelness of pass that around. You can see that the ground is level, probably about maybe 15 feet before the slope drops off. So I don't think that would be an impact on erosion whatsoever. Although it's my
which trees are we looking at here?
That's all those three right here: the 30, the 22, and the 28. There was a question about if they were too close to the embankment fall off, and if it would create a problem with erosion. And they're really not. In an area that I would be concerned about it. But it's my understanding that Jeff and Andy are planning on doing a landscape plan with some new plantings out there that will give the structural integrity needed in that area anyway.
Can you explain the three that are
black cherry and two the
right.
It's
the 8 inches, the 3 8-inches, one is a black cherry, and the two elms?
Yes, and I think we talked about this on
yeah.
the site visit also.
Mm-hmm.
The topography right now, where it stands, there is going to be an increase of soil. Probably, it looked to be about maybe anywhere from 8 to 12 inches. When you put fill, loam, soil over the root structure of any tree, it causes compaction to the root structure, which suffocates the roots. And you've all been seeing this on construction sites where they bring in, you know, yards and yards of fill, and 3 years down the road you'll see trees that are all dying off. Well, anytime a tree looks like a telephone pole going into the ground and you don't see the evidence of the flare of the root, you'll get compaction. It's a slow death, 3-4 years, but it will start and it will kill the trees. And based on what they have for a plan for landscape, that elevation is going to be raised. It's definitely going to be a problem down the road. And I think that's what you were shooting for on that, because this is why you want to go straight down.
Right. And just to add what Bob said, it could be true from the from this tree, it's 120 feet on a slope distance, but we take everything horizontal. So when you pull a tape down a hill, it could be 120, mm-hmm. but everything's horizontal, so the 100-foot buffer line is correct.
Okay. One question I had is, I see the contours, the new proposed contours, but when we were out there, the grass on the property to the left was further as you went towards the wetland, it was quite a bit higher than that land. Is that Are those grades going to marry into that height of the grass, the adjacent grass?
Well, they can, because that's Jeff and Annie's property as well.
Oh.
So they own both properties.
Well, do they propose to do that? I mean...
I didn't know such an extreme height difference there, but I didn't really...
It's more prevalent at the Elms, and then it kind of flattens out further towards the house.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at your 210 contour, it doesn't seem like there's a whole lot that's potentially going on there.
Right.
But, there probably is a decent amount that...
That's probably the 12-inch area of fill.
Yeah.
Further back towards that black cherry, it might only be 4 or 5 inches that would be filled.
My limited grading's in this area, so there's enough room between here and the property line, if need be, if we could make up that difference. I'm not grading right up to the lot line.
Okay.
Where that 10-inch tree is, I'm matching into a grade there. Mm-hmm. Might be a slight change here. But there's room here, if we had to make it, there's room to do so.
Okay.
Yes. Oh, okay. And Jeff just told me there's actually a private septic system here. This property's not on town sewer. They will be connecting to town sewer, so they're gonna have to get back there, pump and crush it. There's no real record of it, that the Board of Health doesn't really have a record of where that tank is.
Isn't that a requirement for the building permit to connect to town sewer?
Not if it passes Title V.
Pardon me?
I think not if it passes Title V, and it passed Title V.
They're proposing to connect to town sewer.
Right.
But there'll also be some disruption to the soil and the root structures when you do dig that out. So, I mean, all the more reason that the roots will be compromised and then it's going to be refilled over time. So my opinion of that is if they're going to do a landscape plan with plantings, and eliminate the hazard now and do a replant, you know, per your request on what you want when you're done with it.
We don't have the landscaping plan yet, do we, in the city?
No.
So the septic system is located where approximately?
Jeff, somewhere in this area, you think?
Yeah, with the 32. The 30-foot and the 22, the 30-foot oak and the 22-foot pine, just in front of that is where the leaching field is, and just closer to the house is where the tank is, and there's also a gray water tank to the left-hand side. Plan is to remove that completely, and then to hook up to the city sewer.
Okay. Okay, I think that needs to be part of this as well. Just, you know, at least add it in the narrative and with the approximate. I mean, I know without having an exact, you can't know exactly where it is, but an approximate area of where you suspect it is.
It might be right at the 100-foot setback line.
Right.
I don't know.
Right. And when it's closed, it... Can you just remind me the standard procedure for that is to excavate and pump out and then fill?
Pump first, and then a lot of times it gets crushed in place and clean fill like sand's brought in for the void.
Yeah, and the...
You rarely see them remove the entire structure, but they have to pump in.
And the leaching field's just left in place?
Left in place. Left. If there is a leaching field, it may just be like a cesspool. But.
Okay. I just wanted to get some idea of the ground disturbance. Okay.
And the town has to sign off on the closure.
Any other questions from the commission? Chuck, do you have questions?
Yeah, I had some questions. I was wondering if we could get those photos submitted with this application.
Yeah.
And if you intended to take the roots out, or you were just going to stump and grind?
My suggestion would be, and I think you hit on this earlier, that, and we didn't discuss it at this point because I didn't know exactly, I hadn't seen the plans for the house, but it's always best not to excavate stumps for the reason you mentioned about keeping some integrity to the slope or to the area in a non-disturbed zone. Excavating, if you do excavate the stumps, then it would certainly have to be filled in properly. But you also run the risk when you leave stumps underground that eventually the roots will compost out and you will get sinkholes. So I think if you folks don't have a set plan on how you want it done, then, you know, your options are flush cut or grind the stumps or excavate and have them properly filled. Now, in the event that they're going to be digging out that septic system and they're going to have a machine back there, my opinion at this point would be to dig them out and properly fill in and then re-landscape, because those tanks are going to be very close to where those stumps are. So it would make most sense to dig them out and prep the ground properly, and then they can actually have more success with a new planting schedule.
That wouldn't apply to that 34-inch pine, would it?
That stays.
That stays.
That's not coming out,
yeah. Yeah, I just for my two cents, just to jump in, we are so far in the outer buffer zone right now that if that's what the applicant wants to do with those three in the back, the 28-inch, the 22-inch, and the 30-inch, I don't have any objection to even excavating. I mean, the erosion control is in place, and I'm sure they'll be replaced. You know, that's one of our standard conditions.
I agree, we're 80 feet away from the wetlands,
right.
So we're
right on,
you know, if we were inside of 50 feet.
And you're at the top
portion of
the slope, and,
right.
You know, I don't...
What I would suggest is they submit their landscaping plan, they identify what they're going to do with each stump, and if it's an area where they're going to re-landscape, it makes sense to excavate it, but if it's back away and they're not going to re-landscape, it might make sense to leave it. So show it on the landscaping plan would be my suggestion.
Just as long as there is a written plan that we know what to go back and check for.
And on the plan, do you want the species identified or what's going to go in?
Yes, please.
And the caliper?
Yes.
Yeah, I was just going to mention that the only thing I didn't get to, and then everyone mentioned it also, is that this just makes a lot more sense with a landscaping plan if we can actually see what's going in. So if that was on your list of things to do, you could put that together and submit it to the commission, and then you're going to be taking out the stumps. So we're going to need some slope stabilization, so you have to tell me what that's going to be and how you're going to address that until grass grows or whatever gets planted.
Well, the erosion control would stay in place until the yard's stable. I think that would be our...
To me, it looks like where the erosion control is would move back a bit.
By back, what do you mean?
Down the slope, because the roots are likely to be further down the slope.
Because the root zone typically goes about approximately as far as the canopy. Right?
Yes, the roots.
Right?
Yes.
So on a 30-inch tree, we're talking about...
Probably a...
30-foot...
30-40-foot...
canopy.
Root, yeah, canopy, yeah.
So we're talking about a
30-foot
diameter around that.
Now,
that
in this actual area...
Well, that would push it away down the slope.
Yeah, it would.
Which wouldn't...
But, so, I mean...
Usually
cutting and pulling out the
usually
stump.
Usually I do like 5 or 10 feet around
the tree. I think that's
in
the purpose
of
what we're trying to do.
I'm just trying to get a sense of...
Yeah, you wouldn't excavate that 30 feet.
No.
You'd make that
slope more unstable. No, you do the bulk of the roots and leave the minor ones to go.
Yeah, but the non-woody and woody roots are going to, during excavation, they're just going to come out, and what stays will just deteriorate. They're not going to cause any disruption. Over the years, because it's such a wooded area, I mean, there's so many leaves and pine needles back there that it's very soft in there anyway.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
I guess at this point, where your next meeting's late February, I know Jeff and Annie were hoping to get going on their tree work. We don't have a landscaping plan at this stage, but.
Yeah, we're going to need to see a landscaping plan.
You will.
Could the tree work be commence with, you know, prior to a landscape plan and make a condition in there so they can move forward and then get the house raised?
Well, what type of tree work? Because you're talking about
well, they have trees
stumping.
They can take down by right, and then the trees that are in question that they're here for now, is there an issue? I mean, if you folks agree on it and it goes through the appeals period, can those trees be removed prior to the landscape plan is what I'm asking.
Well, you can raise the house without our approval because it's out of the buffer zone.
Right.
Right.
But they...
But they're trying to just get a hold.
But they're having, and they have other trees they can do by right, but when
right.
Bob comes in, he'd rather make one mobilization, go take the trees and head back out so he doesn't have to charge them a second mobilization.
Yeah, and there's detail officers involved in the front of this house, so, I mean, it's just a coordination issue, which makes the most sense.
Right.
I think we
so
could...
So you're going to be out there in February raising the house and cutting the trees down?
Yeah.
I mean, we work all the time through the winter with the trees.
Last February?
I have a company now in New Hampshire who they prefer doing the tree dropping
in
the winter because the ground's frozen.
Right. Yeah.
Usually there's snowpack and they like
right.
to work in
yeah.
that
I'm
condition.
Thinking more of raising the heads than last February would not have been a fun endeavor.
No, that's true.
So I think the landscaping plan justifies the tree removal and we're just guessing what that plan's going to be. It is kind of far outside the buffer zone, outer edge of the buffer zone, but that's what I'm hearing. If you intend to do a landscaping and that the way that slope looked to me, I guess you would do that. It would probably be a good thing to have submitted.
Yes, what I kind of was hoping is if we can talk about it, you can say yes or no. But if let's say we close and an order was issued and they wait the appeal and cut the trees, could we come back then with a minor change for the landscaping? We're 80 feet away from the wetlands. He could if they decide to just grass it and a couple planted, it seems where we're 80 feet away, it's to me in six trees coming down.
If I could go backwards a little bit, we're in the outer buffer zone. We're only talking about tree removal. Why aren't we doing an RDA? I mean,
could have been.
RDA. It could have been an RDA.
Definitely could have been.
It could have been an RDA.
Which more, for, I mean, it's like we're here. I guess from my standpoint, what I see Jack's point, you know, if we can set requirements of what the landscaping plan should include for planting, you know, similar to requirements we've had before, I personally don't think I see an issue with we're proceeding with the stipulation that a landscaping plan needs to be submitted as a minor change.
Are the rest of the commissioners clearer than I am on which trees are going?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I do want to add that, you know, since it is the outer buffer zone, if these trees, so I'm not, you know, opposed to these trees being removed, especially with the damage, as long as there is sufficient replanting, and you know, you kind of a little bit run the risk of exactly what that replanting is if you just ask for our approval tonight without the approval of the planting plan. You know, we can't tell you up front whether, you know, that we're approving your planting plan tonight because we don't have it.
I understand.
So, in terms of wanting to remove those trees,
this order's not even written, so we're at the next meeting, anyways.
Oh, okay. So we don't even have paperwork prepared for tonight
so.
Anyway.
Okay.
So a bit of our hands are tied then.
As Chuck points out, we can't do it tonight anyway, but for the record, since we are so far in the outer buffer zone, I could probably live with requiring a planting plan that would have our approval and pick the trees down. But the question I still have is, which stumps are we going to grind, which are we going to level cut, which are we going to excavate? We don't know that yet.
Which, if we cut the trees, we'd leave the stumps. This was just to cut the trees. The stumps would stay in place, and then as part of the landscaping plan, I'd work with Bob to landscape and then say which ones would be removed, which ones would be cut down.
Yeah.
It would just be to drop the trees. We would leave the stumps.
But Chuck's right. If we don't have a drafted order, then we can't approve it tonight, so it's going to be, unfortunately, a month.
And then an appeal on top of that.
Yeah.
I don't think anyone's going to appeal it.
But we're looking at the official technicality of it.
I think it's...
But again, okay. You could raise the house without our approval.
Right.
Well, if that were the case, we would proceed with the tree work that we can do by right, which would give it more accessibility to raise the house and then have to wait for those last six trees.
Yeah.
That works.
which is fine.
Unfortunately,
which might be coincident
we
with the
septic
system work anyway.
Right, yeah. I mean, it's unfortunate that the meeting goes another couple
yes,
of weeks out
is.
Because of scheduling,
well,
but it is what it is.
Right. If anybody wants to join conservation, we'll have less problem with the quorum.
Go.
All right, so I move we continue this to, unfortunately, till the 24th.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? We didn't ask, you know, after the fact, would anybody from the public like to weigh in or have any questions on this? I apologize. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Yes, because 10th is
yeah.
the one that we
yep.
need to. The next item on the agenda is 25 Springvale Road and Randall Road, ANRAD 270-0653. And this is a continuation. We had a site visit with the third party consultant Thursday afternoon, starting at 1 o'clock, with Norse Environmental as well. There were two representatives from Norse and Bob. What is Bob's?
ProCop.
ProCop.
ProCop. Okay, Bob ProCop was a third-party consultant, and he placed some flags in areas that exhibited wetland.
Sorry, Becky.
Mm-hmm.
I know you were there. Al and
Al Couliard was there for some of the time, as was Chuck Taroni and myself. We were in attendance and followed the consultants. And the third-party consultant added some wetland flags in certain locations. I think some of you have seen those new pink flags, and those have been numbered in the field, and I actually don't know if the surveyor has picked up those flags at this point. We are still in receipt of a report from the third-party consultant.
We're not in receipt.
We're waiting.
We're waiting. We're waiting for a report from the third-party consultant. And so we wouldn't have anything further to discuss until the next meeting, which, as you know, is scheduled for February 24th. So I apologize if you folks came and we haven't got more to discuss or review. What I might suggest is, so this doesn't happen in the future, is if you could have one person perhaps coordinate with our administrator, maybe 2 to 3 or even 5 days before the next meeting, just to make sure that we're on the agenda and that you're not wasting your time.
We've received the report, and the third party will be at the meeting.
Right.
I think last week we weren't sure whether Bob could get the report done, and it was kind of up in the air.
Yeah,
so we really didn't have a lot of time that we didn't think that this meeting would, no one would be here. Matter of fact, I just confirmed it with everyone today, and neither one, our consultant or the applicant's consultant, gave me an update on where they are with any of the work that we've requested.
Yep, this gentleman.
I'm Pete Shields from Randall Road. I asked a question in one of the past meetings about color of the flags, and that was put aside by saying that's just the contractor's color and it doesn't really mean any particular condition for that area. I see now, after your visit last week, I guess, they're all the pink-red color, and the other colors are gone.
No, the blue colors are still there.
The blue ones are still there?
The blue colors that had been previously put there by Norse.
Right.
unless somebody took them off, but when we were there, they were still there.
Okay.
So the ones that they put on are blue, but they have a metal clip to them?
There's pink ones with a metal clip.
Yeah.
I saw those.
Now, the new ones with, the new red ones also have a metal clip.
Yeah.
Because they were numbered differently.
Yeah, I checked the numbers. So forth. But some don't. Some of the orange.
Those may be somebody else's. All of the ones that have been put in by the third-party consultant should have a metal tag and a number and a letter.
Yep.
Right.
That's our understanding.
Plus, we were out there and kind of know what to expect on the plan. At least I do, and I'm sure Rebecca
does.
Can
we discuss the site visit, or would you rather wait until we have the report?
I would rather wait till we have the report.
Thank you.
Okay.
You're welcome. Hi.
Pat Shields, Randall Road. Just as an aside, I watched the meeting 2 weeks ago, and I have known the Dodgers for years, and I found it very insulting to have him sit here and, in his own way, accuse us of moving flags or taking flags down at the end of the street, and we should act like adults. And I, for one, he knows me, I know him. His daughter, Lauren, graduated with my younger daughter, Liz. And I know he doesn't know the neighbors, but I do. And there isn't one of us here that's going to cheat or go in and pull flags or move flags. We wouldn't know where to move them anyway. So I just wanted it on the record that that was rather insulting for him to say that. So I'm just saying our side.
Okay? Yes.
Just so you know, those flags are nice to have. You can see when you're in the field. But we have a GPS or latitude,
right,
longitude location of the site.
Right, and I.
So you can, even if the wind blows the flags down or a deer carries them off,
right,
we know where that.
And I know
is.
That, and you have said that numerous times. I just found it very insulting that in his way, because he doesn't, you know, I don't. Casares can do whatever they want with their two bits of land. I don't think it's really what we're arguing for more. The other side of the road that's going to put five houses down there, I think is really more where we're all concerned. And I just, like I said, I've known that family since the kids were little. And he doesn't know my neighbors, I do. And for them, I was insulted that he would even infer that we went down and moved flags. So I just had to say my piece.
Okay. Yes.
Can I ask a couple questions?
If they're, okay.
Sorry.
I may answer them or may not.
All right, that'd be amazing. Frank Coleman, 26 Randall Road. At one of the early meetings when Norris was here, Ms. Scanlon said that when she made the site visit, she was a little surprised that the topography was kind of rough and it was very low there. There were hills and valleys. I'm not using your exact words, but you would ask that the surveyors come back and take another look at it, maybe survey it with the third dimension, you know, height and depth. Did anything come of that?
The work that the applicant is going to do to address those comments hasn't been done yet. So
okay.
It's a wait and see answer. We're waiting to see how they respond to those comments I made and what they're going to provide.
So that task is not for an environmentalist. That task is for a surveyor, correct?
It has an environmental aspect to
that.
It because it speaks to the surface drainage pattern.
Okay.
If a drop of water were to fall on a slope, you need to know which direction that's going to go in.
Well, that hasn't really been resolved yet.
It's not resolved yet.
Still waiting on.
If they've done the survey and just not reported it, or if they haven't been in field to do it.
Chuck said he doesn't know where either one.
We don't know the status of the survey. We're still trying to coordinate with the applicant and our consultant and their consultant, and you know, so it's moving forward somehow, but we don't know. Nobody's promised when they're going to get us a final plan.
There have been surveyors around a lot, and I thought, you know, maybe that's what they were doing. Well, they could have been.
We would hope.
Let's hope so.
Was that after Thursday? Last Thursday?
No, it was
It was the Friday before last.
We got the map.
Wait a minute.
I don't know, it was on a Friday. It was either the Friday before or the day after. But they even down the street and pulled a manhole cover up. We're sticking poles in a manhole. That totally buffaloed me. I had no idea what they were doing there.
I don't know what they were doing either.
Was it on that particular property or is it something else?
They were at
else?
The corner of Randall Road and Lisa Lane, and they had a device. Clearly, they've done this before. They pulled the manhole cover up and rolled it off, and they had this enormous pole they stuck in, and it came out all covered with sludge and mud, and then they wiped it off on one of the neighbor's lawns, and they left. And I said, what the hell? You know, I don't really care as long as they put it back and my car didn't fall in the hole.
It sounds like they're measuring.
So outside of the surveying that they're doing with the Conservation Commission and the resource areas, I'm sure there's other surveying that's going on with the properties.
But these are the same guys.
Well, and it could be the same people. It could have nothing to do with the resource.
Oh, okay. So this is something different.
Could be.
It might be Lynn Burger.
They might be trying to figure out what's happening with the storm drains and whether they're functioning well. I mean, it's just a guess. I have no knowledge of, no report from them, no data. I got nothing.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Well, I was more concerned about the topography because I had remembered your questions about it.
We'll see what happens.
Okay.
Yeah. So we were handed a plan with the topo on it, and that's what we looked at when we were out there on the site, but it's going to be finalized. So.
But I haven't seen that. That was probably a working copy.
So that was
for them to use in the field.
The surveyors did put that together, so that answers some of your question. They're out there doing the topo, and we got a plan with new topo on it, but we don't have the plan with the flags on it that were put on site when we were out there. So.
Okay, so the two-dimensional map of the flags has to be kind of coordinated with the topography map, is what you're saying.
Right. It'll make sense. And then also with the report, because the site report is important for drainage and the habitat.
And my final question, I said I had two. These meetings, let's say, pick a date, 2/24, all the reports are in, you folks talk about it, do you reach a conclusion at that meeting, or do you reach it at the next one, or do you reach it behind closed doors and send us all something in the mail? What happens?
We don't reach it behind closed doors. We reach a decision in an open meeting, and we would hope to do it in 4 weeks, but no guarantees.
Okay, no, we're in no rush.
We love seeing you folks, but we would like to get this.
It was all reruns tonight on TV anyway.
That's true.
Madam Chairman, I think, and I'll stand corrected if somebody's memory is better, but I think we continue this hearing to tonight, so I think we need to open it and recontinue it next time.
Okay, do I need your motion to open?
You can just open it.
Okay, it's open, obviously.
It open.
I move we continue it to the 24th.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you, folks, and again, I apologize that you, and as Ms. Coleman said, it's all reruns anyway, so I didn't miss your favorite shows.
You're welcome to stay for the rest of our hearing, so it's your business if you want.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks
for coming.
Okay.
See you in
the
Okay.
Oh, Mr.
I didn't mean to.
Callow.
He's not here.
Yeah. Chuck.
He's supposed to be here. He's supposed to be here at 10 past.
There's some people that
maybe
aren't.
Maybe he's waiting outside.
Meeting.
Okay. They might be here for.
Who was supposed to be here?
Mr. Callow from Bethune Avenue to talk about the detention retention basin.
He wants to build a basketball court in the detention basin.
No, he's got it. No.
I respectfully ask that you ask the public to please.
Folks, can you guys move outside? Because we still have more business to discuss.
Well,
Let's go. Your chair.
I'm sorry. I got out of control. I'm sorry. I just pretend to marry you.
Well, you know what the thing is?
Mike, did we ever? Can I recycle that?
Is this oak tree? This is blueberry lane. I think we were long done with that.
Long done with that? Yeah. I'm just thinking I missed.
Yeah.
Blueberry lane. Yeah.
I think so.
All right.
I don't think I have that anymore, so.
Thank you.
Okay, so I guess we can cover that item.
I don't know.
Well, we should ask.
I'm sorry. I've seen you before, and I can't remember your last name.
Well, I've never been here before. My name's Harry Curtis.
No, I've seen you.
Earlier today about joining the
commission. Oh.
Oh, great.
So I figured I'd come down and see what it was all about before I left the park.
Right. I hope we didn't scare you away.
No, it's interesting.
No.
Were you a neighbor of that property on Main Street? Didn't you come to the meetings? No? Somebody look like you?
No.
We can work this into the agenda. Sure, okay.
Excuse me, could you please either have a seat or move into the hall so that we can continue our business?
I thought we were going to let you go home.
Leave the door open.
We'll
leave that open. Yes, please.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
Yes. My biggest reservation is the heat in this room.
Yeah.
We can't open the windows.
Do you mind giving a little background about your interest in conservation?
Sure.
Leave that open, please. Leave it open.
Yes. Closed door.
It's okay.
Can't yell through that.
So, did you guys have someone named Clark Petchek on this? He might have been on zoning board.
Not in the last 15 years.
Yeah, no, he was a neighbor of mine. He moved away a few years ago. But I live on Haverhill Street, 668, right on the corner of Batchelder. And my kids have gotten older, and I have more time in the evenings. And I work for Bank of America. I've been there for 30 years. And just really, I'm a survivor. And, I called Chuck today because I've been thinking a lot about what I could do to give back to the community. And I have a daughter with muscular dystrophy, and it's really hard for me to do anything too far from home. So I got thinking about, well, what could I do that's local, that's helpful, so I went on the town's website and saw you guys had an opening, and thought I'd explore it. So my background is helping small businesses manage their businesses better, and I run a big business for Bank of America, and very interested in the environment. I take care of one of the trails over at Bear Meadow,
mm-hmm.
Just as a volunteer, and my son and I are always up in the White Mountains hiking. And so I've always been interested in the outdoors and the environment, and so I just thought this would be a good thing to do.
Great.
Okay.
Very cool.
You submitted your application?
I faxed the form in this afternoon.
Awesome. Great.
So,
do you have any questions?
That's the first start. Yeah.
Yeah.
Starts with that.
Do you have any questions? Or?
You know, I did, but I learned an awful lot tonight just by watching, because I really, and I was a, you may not think this is relevant, I think it's really relevant. I was a human resources executive for 5 years. And dealt with all kinds of interesting interactions between people, which I can see is something that comes up from time to time, especially when you're looking at cutting down trees and putting up houses. I guess the question that struck me a little bit was, you know, these guys were whispering about, I make sure I record all those meetings to make sure that what I said is what I said. Do you guys ever get sued? Or is it, as part of the board?
We get appealed.
You get appealed?
Our decisions have, in the 15 years I've been on the board, we've had two or three decisions appealed.
Okay.
And that would be appealed to the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection?
There are two ways to appeal. Let me back up, if I could, if you guys don't mind.
about 90-some percent of what we do as a commission is administer the state's wetland protection law and the sister town bylaw for wetland protection. That's mostly what we do. So if somebody wants to build or do anything within 100 feet of wetland, they need a wetland permit. And we determine if what they're proposing is consistent with the State Wetland Protection Act and the town bylaw. If we make a ruling, either granting the permit or denying the permit, it can be appealed. The state wetland permit is appealed to the state DEP, Department of Environmental Protection. The town bylaw permit is appealed through the court system. So there are two different avenues.
So, and I, you know, and I asked Chuck about...
Can I answer the question, though, too? It's a simple one. Commission can be sued. I think there was
one... We can't
one,
be sued as individuals.
There was something where they were threatening. It was a long time ago. Were you on the commission at that point?
What were the grounds?
That was named.
I can't remember. It would have been 20, 25 years ago.
So, and it would have to be because you interpreted the statute wrong, right?
No, that would be
an appeal. Appeal.
Okay. It could be an appeal.
I think what you're thinking of, Becky, the Board of Selectmen illegally fired the chair of the Conservation Commission. She then sued the Board of Selectmen.
Oh, okay.
And was awarded monetary damages. Course, like it was ruled to be outside of their authority.
Okay.
I don't know the time when an individual said, I don't think.
It's definitely not recent.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like it's something
it hasn't
they need
happened
to worry
in
about.
The last 10 years plus.
Yeah. And, you know, I talked to Chuck about, you know, my background, and he gave me a little bit of a explanation of what you're all engineers and smart, intelligent people, and my background is very, very different. So I said, well, you know, is it practical and helpful for me to actually be part of this or not? And he said, yeah, sure. So.
Well, we're always looking at different perspectives.
I'd say, you know, I think diversity in thought in a group is always good. You know, you don't want too many of the same backgrounds. So.
Yeah. At the same time, I think, technically speaking, there's going to be some learning curve.
Oh, sure. It sounds like it.
And, you know, and I myself, I'm around Reading a lot. I'm home with my three kids all the time. So, you know, I can squeeze out some time here or there to meet for a coffee, answer questions, and or, you know, give you an overview of, you know, technically... what there is to support lacks of whatever you're missing.
Yeah.
At the same time, there's also in the spring in March coming up soon is a State Wetlands Conservation Commissioners Conference at Holy Cross that I myself am going to. I hope a lot of
people
go
to.
There's classes and workshops and
although
Q&A.
It's a little dry, you might want to also look at the Wetlands Protection Act.
Yep.
And also our bylaws, and that'll give you a feeling for, you know, what we have to abide by. And also, it's good to look at the applications that these folks are sending in, and there are examples
of that.
Those
attached in the minutes?
Or
no. They are submitted to us in packets, and Chuck, correct me if I'm wrong, but there's also a copy of all the applications.
Down
so they don't. You don't put them online anywhere. You just
no.
Okay.
No.
Keep it in a box.
Yeah, I've got an extra here if you're interested in seeing a copy. It's public record now. It's Blueberry Lane. It's not from last year. So.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. So as you can tell, the big issues lately have been tree cutting.
Yep.
That's a big issue, and we're probably going to have a meeting to discuss some of the issues that have been coming up and get a little bit of consistency of how we, you know, vote on these particular issues.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I can see how just having an arborist, that was pretty interesting, because he's on both sides of it, right? He wants to get paid to cut down trees, and he also wants to give you a balanced perspective.
Well, that's...
He's got to do both.
That's a concern.
Yeah, yeah, well, but, you know, people are trying to live in the town and make it work, so... Makes sense? Makes sense?
So moving forward with this process, what the town, I think, does next is they'll interview you. There's a volunteer subcommittee.
Okay. Of the selectmen?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, subcommittee.
Yep, I think there's two selectmen.
Two or three.
Who,
two. I was interviewed by two.
Three.
Oh.
Yes.
I think it's down to two right now. But so they interview you, and that's done here at Town Hall. And
okay. And
based on those, and...
But that takes a while because they don't meet real regularly.
Yeah,
it almost took
that.
Like in a month to
okay.
get...
Yeah, I think it's a once a month that they...
did it take you about a month
yeah.
to get your interview? Yeah, it took me about a month.
And how long have you all been doing it?
Nine.
About 27, no, I've been doing it about 13 or 14 years.
Okay.
I've done it maybe...
Total.
9 years, but I started a stint in the 80s, the mid 80s, then 2003, and now recently.
And I've been on for about the last 9 years.
I'm on the commission for about 6 months, eight months maybe. So relatively new.
Okay.
And we have only one other member who's only been on a few months. Seven is our. Authorized number, and to conduct business, we need a quorum of four.
Okay. And so you're at six right now, or you're at five right now?
We're at five right now.
Five.
Okay.
We're at five. There's also some associate members, too.
Who?
There are?
Non-voting associate members.
There can
to
be.
Conservation.
We don't
have any. Oh.
There can be.
Okay.
There can't be.
I started as an associate commissioner.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's a non-voting member.
Actually, under the new bylaws, if we don't have a quorum, the chair can appoint an associate member to be a voting member for that particular meeting.
We need an associate member.
Yeah.
You could just pick somebody on the street.
As you can see, with five, so we had six, we recently lost a member. With five, it can be difficult to get a quorum. We want to, it's... You've heard the applicant and the coordinator, they were hoping to get things moving and get things started. You know, it's not our hope to have things canceled.
Right.
We want things to move along. As long as they fulfill the requirements. So.
Yep.
The more members, the better.
Yeah, no, I understand. That makes sense.
So do you want to stay for the rest of our business?
Sure.
Oh, great.
So I was able to get a hold of Eddie Carlo. And he had to go to take us on family business. He did leave me a message, but I didn't get that because it was after the meeting started. I did call him, and he says he can make it here within 20 minutes.
Okay.
So that would be about 10 past 9, and we might have just enough other business to stretch that.
Okay.
Well, we don't have information on
Mariano
Drive.
I did talk to Al asking for when we went out to a site visit, he just go over what we saw. We saw some erosion, and we saw the fact that there was a lot of grass grass was sparse at best at one of the sites, and there was some material in the wetlands. And I think Jamie's going to help us with this because I talked to Al about the chunks of concrete that was forming that pile in the wetlands. But there's also other debris, metal and trash, and things like that.
Right.
Al said the commission's going to remember that to disturb it was going to be more of a problem. Now, that kind of jogged my memory, and I think that those big sections of concrete, we did say that he did not have to move those.
I thought some of
the
trash that
but
we
the
saw,
trash,
we could
different
pick
story
up by
altogether.
Hand. There were small pieces, remember?
Yeah.
My memory is that we would make ruling on a subsequent site visits on a case-by-case basis after we understood more completely what was in there and what damage would be caused by removing. Mm-hmm. That's what my memory says.
And I recall from those hearings that Al would sit before us and say, you know, whatever you want me to do, and do you want me to clean up that that slope? And I remember kind of going, yeah, I want you to clean up that slope. You know, but again, it wasn't exactly, you know, what does that mean? Take out the biggest pieces so it kind of doesn't look like it's all fill back there.
But there was always the question, if you remember, it looked like the island from the gas station.
I remember it well.
And we wanted that removed, but then what was behind it? Was it two more islands? Or,
well, if it's...
So we just didn't know enough to make a finite direction. We needed to see work in progress and make a determination. And as Anita said, Al said, it's fine with me.
I guess we didn't make a decision on the cement, and there's a lot of cement back there. This is pretty much a hill that drops off quickly,
mm-hmm.
and right at the base, within a foot, sometimes not even within a foot, is the wetland line.
Right.
Yeah.
So any disturbance, I mean, would you take everything out and then rebuild the hill, or would you take everything out and...
Chuck, wasn't there a large boulder underneath that concrete? I remember seeing, like,
I think it's a lot of mixed.
I think
mixed
it's just
in
debris. And
I think, but there was a car seat, like a white vinyl car seat that was becoming part of the wetland.
So I asked Al
so
several times to clean the wetlands.
It needs the junk needs to get out of the wetland.
Has he completed the house?
He's looking for his certificates of compliance.
Does he have an occupancy permit?
He has people living there.
Yeah. Two of them, at least.
So there's three houses there. One's for sale. Lot 2 and 3 are occupied.
And did the commission make site visit on Monday?
Yes. No.
Yeah, this was
last
previously.
Monday. Yeah, 2 weeks ago from Monday.
Well, I think the family and mine are pretty consistent.
Which is amazing.
We wanted some cleanup, but we weren't able to say exactly what until we had a better understanding of what the structure of that slope was.
That's kind of what we found.
So what's the path forward? I mean, I would have preferred that all of that was gone. Now I do think it's, you know, the larger stuff is gonna make more of a mess than it's worth. But there's junk in there, there's stuff that you can grab by hand, there's stuff that, and that should be gone, that should be taken out.
I have some erosion issues going.
Yeah, and I mean that's completely separate as well, but yeah, additional. I just want to make sure we get this, because it seems wide open of what did we ask him to do, what are we going to ask him to do. I think it from what I'm hearing, it though is a consensus of if it's easy to pick up, if it can be picked up by hand, he should be getting that out of the...
Yeah, all the trash has to go. I don't think that's a
good question.
The question is taking in things that could compromise the structure of that slope. That was a concern.
I think getting the concrete...
The work that would be involved.
You couldn't do that by hand. No. You need something mechanical to get that. And now you're
talking about ripping up that whole area.
Yeah.
It's going to make it would make a mess.
I mean, that whole fill area, I think from my solid waste days is like old, like, you know, landfill type stuff. You know, it's, like you saw, it was the, like island pumps and car parts. And if that's the nature of the waste that's buried there, you kind of don't want to unearth it too much, you know? Because you're going to kind of re-mobilize it, expose it, and then how far? Well, it can't go too far because he was able to build houses, right? So he didn't, did he get into trash when he built his infiltration area? And but if I were one of those residents living in one of those houses,
that's a different story,
I would be,
though.
I would have a strong opinion about that stuff being in my backyard between my house and this lovely wetlands that's giving me a lot of, like, lovely natural views and stuff like that.
So,
have you heard any complaints from them? Or?
Yeah. I mean, I don't disagree. But
I don't think they've been out there.
They live in there.
They live there.
They live there, but I don't think they've walked.
They can imagine.
See it. I would buy a property without walking over, and I don't know about you.
Yeah, you could see it.
I need to revisit the site, I think.
Yeah, so I don't know. I'm just hearing that in some sense that we left some of that responsibility on ourselves.
Yeah.
Now, I had gone out and did many site walks, and I remember when you were chair, you had to meet Al there once to talk about a retaining wall.
Yep.
So.
And I remember that discussion with him.
Yeah. So just to fill you in a little bit more, part of this certificate of compliance, it's 2 and 3. So lot
two and three.
So lot 3 has extra stuff, and so does lot 2. So it has, we didn't permit the bocce court, we didn't permit a fieldstone retaining wall and an actual, what do you call that other? Yeah, there's another retaining wall that's more professionally put together, and some stairwell on that, different slopes, all different back there. All these things were done without permission from the Conservation Commission. They're all outside the 35-foot area. But still, they were done.
Without minor projects, without minor plan changes, or
No,
they were just done.
They were just done and submitted as a request for certificate.
And he made a great comment when I was talking to him. You can imagine just how the conversation went. But he just said, "You allow this kind of stuff because in your order of conditions, you say that." The engineer needs to state that you're in substantial compliance with the order of conditions. He believed that there was a lot of slack in that statement. So maybe we should look at that.
Didn't we say on that order of conditions that no other structure would be any closer? I'd really like to see another reprinted copy of these orders of conditions. So. Because I thought I recalled that no structure would be closer to the wetlands than what was already presented on the existing plans.
Yeah,
to close that loophole.
There is nothing closer than...
Well, the retaining wall.
No, it's not closer than the outfall. The flared in and the riprap is at the 25-foot.
Is it between that and the house?
Yes, the bocce court and the retaining wall. And
I
that
thought
little
he
rock.
Didn't build the bocce
court. Yes,
there's
the bocce
a bocce court there.
That's a lot, too.
Is that? Okay. Well, I'd like to reinvestigate the letter of the law in the order of conditions. And
so, outside of all that, the cement and all that and what it's going to take. So I asked him several times to clean this up, and he did. I could see that things were gone each and every time, but it was never completely cleaned. And there was big material still in the wetlands, so we wanted that done, part of it, as part of this order. The erosion is pretty bad on lot 2.
Mm-hmm.
The grass hasn't come in. The grass was just hydroseeded there, and it wasn't watered, and it's very sparse, and it created erosion. So there's that issue, too. So
isn't that lot 3?
Is it lot 3 and 2?
I think it's two that has the bocce court, and three was the one.
So it comes around the other side?
Yeah, I think so. That's two.
Yeah,
this
that's
is the
two.
One with the bocce court.
Right.
Yep, two has the bocce court.
Yeah.
So three is the
three
first
is the
one,
one with erosion.
You encounter as you go around
there
the cul-de-sac.
There is some erosion at two. Remember on the side coming down?
Back
yeah.
here?
Yes.
Yeah. That's
yeah.
where the hay bales were, right there. So they graded up to the hay bales, and when they removed them, there's like a gully now all the way down.
Seems to me what we need is a punch list and give it to the applicant and say until the punch list is completed, you don't get yours.
Don't disagree.
And that punch list might be something like remove debris from the wetland and the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation to meet Conservation Commission approval.
Okay, but you gotta, are you including the concrete on that slope or not? That's because that's at the 20, within that 25 feet.
I guess.
And
I
think the conversation has been that you'd have to get some kind of mechanical vehicle down there or some kind of vehicle to lift that stuff. Stuff is really heavy. So it would cause more erosion.
The slope, the whole back, that whole yard is slow.
Right.
It would be.
Well, that's, I mean.
We don't want to lose stability of that slope.
No, absolutely not. I mean, my thought, the way I envisioned when we talked about this, was that we go ahead and deal with the applicant and say, okay, this block goes, this block stays. That was kind of what I thought. Flag them, just like what trees you're going to get.
It sounded to me like we could agree about loose
refuse in the wetlands.
Stuff that's separated from the slope and is just hanging around in the wetlands. Away from the base of the slope. In regards to the slope itself, I think whatever can be pulled out, it would...
By hand? No?
Yeah.
I don't think you're going to be pulling anything off that slope.
I don't think you are either.
It's all interlocked. It's
at this
you're
point,
either
it's
attacking the slope. I mean,
it should have been done beforehand.
Even
it's
George.
Not,
it was in construction.
Yes, but it's.
He had.
But that's
he
not,
never.
But that's not our.
He never had any intentions of pulling that out. And because I remember George Zambores, you know, telling me that he's going to have to, you know, he's going to have to pull that stuff out. But then he. But then he.
It.
Yeah, he just built the house.
That's what it looks
kind
like
of
to me.
Within
is,
it.
He just filled right into it.
Everyone kind of thought that he was going to be confronted with the obvious fact that this stuff needs to be removed. And he, you know, he just kind of got out of that. He just kind of worked his way around it
okay.
for the whole project.
You know, if it's illegal to leave it in place from, like, a solid waste standpoint, you know, that's not our jurisdiction. Our jurisdiction is to protect the habitat and the resource area.
Well, there is a bond on this one. So.
Well, how about
and he's looking for his certificates of compliance.
Can we get the bond release?
Yeah. Why don't we make that punch list?
I'll start the punch list and I'll send it around.
Can we see the order of conditions as well?
And I'll send out the orders of conditions. Except for the roadway seemed to be, I didn't see any issues with the roadway. You know, although it's not complete.
It's not done yet.
But
so
the drainage structures are operating well, or?
I think they're, didn't we see a cap in one of them?
Yes.
So I don't know why that's capped. So.
Capless, like it won't drain?
Well, it's
capped. I think it's capped because they don't want it to run off right now.
List.
It's got a...
No,
there is
we're not going to approve them.
Yeah, so let's get stuff.
Yeah, so we've got...
And move on.
It's
okay.
going to move on.
Yeah.
We've got more to do with that. It's not ending. Oh. Ending here.
Okay, let's add a punch list.
Thank you, Chuck.
And look at the orders of condition.
I think it's important to say that when we do this... for the open meeting laws, that you need to just send, I'm going to send it out, you have a comment, don't hit reply all. You can just come, guys, has to come back just to me.
Yeah.
Agreed.
So it doesn't become a discussion.
Is the commission comfortable with going out there again?
I am.
Certainly.
Maybe we go out there on those site visits that punch limit, punch list in hand and edit it during the site.
Good.
I think that's good.
Before the snow flies, this Sunday?
No, I think it's gonna be 50 degrees on Sunday.
No, do you want me to set up a site visit for this Sunday?
No.
No. It's 50 degrees, you can't ski. Well, you've been there.
All right, fine.
I'm tied up for Sunday.
So.
Does it work during the week, Monday, Tuesday, for you, Jamie?
My schedule unfortunately is highly variable and flexible. Sometimes I don't know until Monday whether I have to go into the office on Tuesday. I just don't know.
Well, I wouldn't want to do it without Jamie there.
Sure, we'll try it then.
And if you can go,
and
then we'll do it.
Al should be there too, so if he's in Florida, we're not going to get very far.
I think he's gone for a while. I think he's gone until
the 3rd. February 3rd.
Which is next week.
Next week.
Right.
Next Wednesday.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have all next
why
week.
Why don't we shoot for Monday, maybe? During
Well, Al won't be here.
But
he needs to be there.
Is it easier in the end?
Yeah.
The end of the week, like Thursday, Friday?
Why wouldn't we have a separate meeting?
Yeah, I think it makes sense to create a punch list and have the
you guys come up with
commission walk and make sure this is what we agree with it, that this is what we want to be done, and then we can present it to the applicant. And if Al wants to, at that point, walk with us and say, all right, what do you want me to do? This is unclear, or what do you want me to do? I think at that point, you know, we could do something further. Does that make sense?
We'll have to go back with him the second time.
Mm-hmm.
If that's required, I think that's fine. I think it's
a little bit of a conflict if he's there when we're making the punch list.
It's never.
It's his property.
Yes.
Never a problem to have him there. Yeah, you.
We gotta
I mean,
let him know.
Okay.
Oh, he doesn't actually. Well, you can let him know. You don't need his permission because we still have an open order of conditions.
Right.
So. But I would, you guys shouldn't care whether he goes or not, either anytime, you know, it's going to be the same. You're going to be able to do your work with him there or not. So we're looking at the site visit for next Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, something like that. Thursday, Friday?
Sure.
Thursday, Friday. I will just send it to everyone. Including Al, and well, actually, I won't send it to Al. I'll send him a separate email inviting him to it.
Good.
So that's that. Let's see what happens.
Okay. Oh yes, partner. Do you have any minor projects?
There are no minor projects.
What about unauthorized activity?
And there's none. We've been quite fortunate during the winter months that no one's told us about unauthorized activity and nothing's been spotted on our site visits.
Okay. But the administrator's report, have you sent out sections of the annual report you would like us to?
You sent us last year's, I think.
Did I send it?
You sent us.
It was.
Page and a half from 2014.
Is that all that was?
Oh, that was last year. So I actually started working on it and have a pretty good, you know, copy of what I want in there. Obviously, you can make any changes you want, but what I did is I asked the commission to write about certain things. Now I gave a list, and I would like everyone to pick something and just write it, and then we maybe could update it every year. Tier Cabin,
yep.
Bear Meadow, some good project we worked on, the Landers Lane oil transformer spill, something like that.
Who actually reads these?
We just pretend we have. It's just like the entire environmental field.
Like
it's our thing. It's for us.
No, seriously, who reads the reports?
I have to read the past reports to help me with this, but
does Gene read them?
Oh, you mean in town hall? I'm sure Paula, the Paula, what's her last name?
Jebby.
Shenna, what's in it?
Yeah, the
yeah, the selectman secretary reads them. I'm sure Bob would read them.
I think there is a good summary of at least in the 2014, there was a good summary of all the permits, all the everything.
Right.
That
it's always added.
I think there's it does keep a good track of the work being performed.
And this
okay,
becomes
I'm not arguing that. I'm just
wondering
if we're going to write it, who is our audience? Who are we writing it for?
The people
is it town record?
The town.
Is it town record?
Don't you send the annual report out to the people in the town? It, what is it? Just
meeting members, don't get it.
Wow.
Is it a town
I would assume that your audience
website?
Is the selectmen, town manager, and interested parties throughout the town.
And it includes all commissions?
All departments, yeah.
Okay, so yeah. It's on the town website, so it's open to the public.
Yeah, it would be nice. I mean,
yeah,
little personally. So anyways, that's what I will send it out. It is almost completely ready, but you know what killed me? That last part where it says, this year the commission started out with Suss and Schuster's chair and vice chair, and then it was these people on the commission, and then we lost two, and I couldn't get through that. It was just like, oh my God. So many people dropped off and left and became this and then dropped. It's like, how do I phrase this in such a way that it's understandable?
Yeah.
So
timeline.
Yeah.
Timeline and bullets.
For water and sewer, Pearl Street, 1344.
We have a water and sewer bill.
The water and sewer, actually, it's not water and sewer,
stormwater fee.
For Pearl Street property.
I will
for
second.
For frontage or road.
All those in favor?
Great.
Yeah, pass the hat to get the money.
Oh, you want to talk about money?
No.
Entering this year with $700.
It's slim.
The rest is accounted for, or has been earmarked for other things.
Speaking of bills, I drove by Materia Cabin. I forgot where I was going, but when I drove north by there, there were two or three cars, the lights were on Materia Cabin. When I came back, cars were gone, but the lights were left on.
So facilities has taken over Materia Cabin, some of their maintenance. They're not going to do a lot, it doesn't seem like, but they you know, like the security system and the lights, these safety issues that they're doing, those lights are on because facilities wants them on. I don't know if they stay on all night and they go off at any time, but there's no way to turn them off from inside the cabin.
We were there not that long ago when we tried.
I think we want those lights off. There are owls that used to nest in those trees in front. If we leave those owls off, those lights on, that's not going to happen. We do not want those lights on.
Why were they keeping them on? Was it just to keep
security? They didn't want
the
owls breaking into Materia Cabin.
or you know, random people or youth, you know.
So
I don't even know. You know what?
Well lit is.
It just happened. This is nothing. No one even asked me about it.
Yeah.
So I certainly can start that conversation.
Yeah,
tell them about the owls.
I mean, it's our cabin. We should be able to turn around that we want lights on.
Or at least
tell
put them on
have
motion sensor
out
or something.
Yeah.
Something a little more conservative.
You didn't see anything else over there?
I saw some great boulders.
Did you?
As I said, there were a number of cars there when I was going north.
We did the winter walk this Sunday.
Right.
And we had a picture of 16 cars in the parking lot. And you know what? I told you, like, people just, you can't control them. They park wherever they want, but we got a couple going in the right way. But after the fact, they were actually parked on both sides, so up against Matera and up against the slope.
Good.
And then the travel lane was in the center, and it looked great.
It worked.
It worked great.
Good. Good.
It was wonderful. It's a great picture. You know,
people
could come in and go, and plenty of room.
Great.
It's just getting that first person to park the right direction. Everybody else will follow suit.
Serious, the Pied Piper thing going on there. I sent you the report for the environmental impact report for North Reading.
Yeah.
Does anyone intend to go to that?
I'm
That's next Thursday.
If I get there at 9 a.m. and finance 9 p.m., I'm coming over your house for breakfast.
Will I be there?
I've had public meetings at 9 p.m.
No, until 9 p.m. I'm wondering if you're going to be over for that.
It'd be nice if there was, a few people going. I know some.
Is George going? I hope.
I'm not sure. I would say George is going. I would say, town manager. I'm not sure about that. I was asked today if the commission was going by Gene.
I'd like to go.
I'm going to try.
Yeah. But is that the day that we're doing the invasives talk? Because you said it's the 4th or the 11th.
Yeah.
So is it that day? Because if it is.
We're doing it on the 11th.
What invasive talk?
We're doing an invasive talk. Well, that's not at 9 in the morning. That's at between 2 and 4 in the afternoon.
I just would like to have some part of the day.
To prepare?
No. I just don't want to double book a day, that's all.
There's an Envirothon at the that the
high school
seniors are being involved in this year down in Amherst, and the topic is invasive plants. So I was contacted by the teachers, and they're going to come in and talk. We're going to give a talk, and we're going to have a discussion group going about what.
Who's we?
Well, me and Anika are going to do this. And
if you'd like to join us,
yeah,
come on in.
When is it?
It's on the 11th between 2:30 and 4.
I'm not here that week.
Well, if your schedule changes.
So they want to know how active the town is in combating invasives throughout the town, and do we have an active plan or policy to, to fight the invasives, whether it's aquatic or...
Is tree warden going to be there?
No.
It'd be good to have him there.
Might be. Maybe get Bob.
Because about 15 years ago, he was running around town planting Norway maples. So it'd be nice to have him there. He can explain why he did that.
Is there a learning experience for more than just the high school students?
To you. So I'll invite him if you show up. So you'll have someone to
follow. I think it'd be good for him to be there. Because he does, we only have jurisdiction in a small percentage of the town. He's throughout the town and on public land. He could tell them, I hope, that he doesn't plant invasive species.
He's removed them from the tree lot. Was there ever a tree lot here? Usually each town has one.
We did in colonial times, but I don't think we do anymore.
Yeah.
So anyways, that's what that is. It's just an Envirothon. It seems like it'd be pretty interesting. So that's just one of many. I mean, there's always things like that going on. Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts,
yeah.
High school kids,
whatever. To kind of dovetail that, if I can just jump in for a sec, I found out about a geology opportunity, a free opportunity for high school girls to do some alpine glacier mapping. But so I used that as an excuse to email the head of science at the high school and just sort of introduce myself and tell her about that opportunity to spread among her students, and to also let her know that I was probably going to be involved in the marathon, and to offer myself as like a resource or a connection between conservation and the high school. I think reaching out to the residents, the different schools, in a way that, Matera Cabin could become a center for education, for conservation, and a place that kids in town could go for a field trip. And so I just wanted to make sure that the schools knew about that. So just thought I'd mention it, that I was trying to make that connection. Of course, haven't heard back.
Okay. I'd like to add something. I'd like to potentially schedule some kind of a strategic meeting at Matera. Not on a Wednesday, obviously. But
When are you not around?
Definitely Tuesday nights I'm not around.
Yeah, but in February. Is February too soon, or why don't we, what about March, the end of March?
Yeah, anything works.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm pretty open.
Okay.
Barring school vacations.
No, this doesn't have to be, this isn't an open a meeting, right? It's just
No, you have to.
It has to be posted as
an open. We have a quorum, it has to be.
As a matter of fact, when you guys all go to Sanborn Lane, if you all go, I have more than four people going,
No, no, site visits are exempt.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we don't post our site meetings on every week. Site meetings are exempt.
Yeah, we post.
That's why we can't discuss or make decisions on a site meeting.
Sorry.
They're exempt from the public meeting law.
Okay. So I'll try to come up with an agenda and throw out some dates.
Throw out a date and an email and then we can.
So throw out some dates, but it's used, so run the dates past
me
first because
I
have to check the calendar.
Right.
Okay.
All right. Yeah.
Why don't you throw out some dates?
Okay. Well, I think most nights are fine. If it's going to be nights, you guys, night, but weekend, Fridays and weekends seem not to be, but nights still are fine.
But that material's getting used.
It's actually used a lot. It's just not rented a lot.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it's just.
You can use it for free.
Which is fine. I mean, it's getting used and it's got the parking. And I was contacted by someone who was interested in doing a child yoga class for 6 weeks.
That would be fun on those terraced
slopes
in the spring.
Yes. Yes. I mean, it pays not much. It's good, though. I think it gives people the opportunity to,
mm-hmm.
you know, use it. And, you know, we do run a deficit over there, so it would be nice to get a little bit closer to what we need.
Okay, so we've got Mr. Callow here.
Hello.
Hey.
Good evening.
Loving. Good. 11 Bethune Avenue?
Yes. Thank you very much. I apologize for my delay in getting here.
So we have a surprise for you, Eddie, if you just watch the board. Go. Here it is.
Okay.
Okay.
That's your thing.
That's what's there now, correct, Chuck?
That's well, in concept, it's there. It's not there in...
The last two pictures of
that. Want...
Well, if you want to see what we're actually looking at as well. The last two pictures are of the pit and the dry time was there. What I'm proposing to the commission is that we just bring just, it.
So I'm sorry to interrupt. Lot 3 or lot 4?
Lot 4.
Okay.
And the last two on the
all
bottom.
The pictures?
No, you want to go to all the, to the very bottom, the last two, 19 and 29. Because the other ones have the picture of the driveway stuff. So as we're looking here, this is the part we looked at yesterday when we were
mm-hmm.
there. You can see the low areas. So what I propose to do is to bring it up to the existing plans levels that are on with the that are registered with the town. So the measurement as George came out was he was saying it was a couple inches below. When I had mentioned it was 18 inches, that was what my measurement was for how it dropped right at the mouth of that, where this, the rock pile
yeah,
is, right here is where the mouth of that drain is. So basically what we want to do is we want to just bring it back up to the way it was supposed to be. From what my limited knowledge is that the area here is just from settling, because it's new land. So they built that in, and we just want to bring it back up to the grade that it is, because it holds water. From a long period, I know we had a bad winter last year, but even the first year we moved in, it'll hold water until June. So it's very tacky, and obviously with the mosquito stuff that we have going on, that's what made me question it. Is it supposed to run that way? And it's not supposed to run that way. It's supposed to just be up to the levels it's supposed to be. So that's my proposal.
What are you going to fill it with?
By the standards of the existing plan, I think it's called 1/8 fill. I'm not very familiar. I had my landscaping construction gentleman who was going to meet me here at 8 o'clock, of course. That got sidetracked. But it's according to the plans, we weren't going to deviate anything from the plans as far as fill or anything else like that. So it would be exactly what the town wants us to do. We just want to bring it back up to its the level it's supposed to be at, the grade.
So you cut that grass to the lawn, right?
I do. I maintain it for the town. I cut all that. I clean out the drainage. I crawl through and make sure nothing's in there, no varmint or anything like that, yeah. Just to make sure that it runs smooth. So yes, I do. I cut that up, keep it clean.
Is that your preference, to cut the grass, as opposed to just letting natural vegetation grow?
That's my preference, to keep it tidy and clean, yeah, it is. I mean, it's just grass that's growing there, and there's not really much vegetation there. It's just, you know, it's not conservation land or wetlands or anything like that. It just seems to be that we're not at the level where the water table is.
And what's the, you told us before, but I've forgotten, what's the square feet of area you're going to fill?
I think it's approximately 400 square feet. Again, when we get in there, we would have to look at it.
400?
Yeah, from what I'm talking about here, because again, with my limited knowledge, once we get in there, I'm talking, what I mentioned, I was about 400 square here. The construction gentleman is talking about making it all to the grade that it's supposed to be at, it will exceed that. I'm just talking about the section I'm talking here. So I would say for roughly the whole structure, maybe about 1,000 square to 1,200 square.
And this is something George Zamboris has...
George Zamboris has been out on multiple occasions and wanted to wait till after rain, before rain, all that stuff. So we've gone through that process the past year. And he agrees that it has to be, some fill has to be brought back in. And that's, I think, where the question lies about whether it goes off the bond or if Mr. Couliard is going to come back and do the work.
Is George going to come back after you finish and check this against the plan?
Exactly.
He is?
Yep.
Are you going to produce an as-built of that plan, or?
Did he ask me for an as-built?
No, are you going to produce an as-built of that plan?
I'll produce whatever the committee wants me to produce. I have an as-built as well as the town has, just to make sure that we're at that levels, and George has it as well, so we would go right to the letter of the law on that aspect.
Yeah, I think he would ask you for that. I mean, it's not
too many ways
to tell. George would want that to show that it's actually built to the elevation.
Yep.
So,
he's talking about this.
I mean, from our standpoint, I don't.
And I know that George is involved with this. We were waiting months for George to go out there and check it out and say that the work could be done.
Mm-hmm.
So he.
I've got the verbal from George, the work can be done. Now it's to the point of, you know, who does it, or when do we do it? Obviously, we do it springtime or summertime this year, if everything is approved by the committee.
So you're bringing it up to the original design?
I'm bringing it up to the original plan you have in front of you now.
I guess my question is, what permit vehicle does this get work get done under?
Drainage structures are not within jurisdiction.
That's right. It's within.
Could be considered
feet
maintenance.
Of the wetlands, but it's not a wetland, and it's basically maintenance. You consider it maintenance. You could also. What else could, if we wanted a paper trail?
I'm not sure we are within 100 feet of the wetland.
We are.
Right.
Maybe the far.
You can see the stones in this picture.
Oh yeah.
I'll point a couple out to you. There's one right here. There's one right here. That was the 25 markers.
Yeah.
And the wetland comes around the side where that picture is too. So it's in
behind us. Yeah.
It's at our back.
Which actually runs into block 3.
Is it,
you know, if you're going by, if you're good, so.
Might not be.
Halfway through the.
I mean, the only thing that you could do for a paper trail is just to request the as-built after it's complete.
Yes.
And maybe George will give his blessing, but at least the as-built. I'd like to get something in writing that George is allowing this.
Okay.
because I know he said he gave his verbal. He also said the same thing to me.
Okay.
And, I don't really, I think this is set up to be maintained. There's an access road that was built into this project you know, so much, a lot of this damage won't happen to the slopes.
Usually maintenance of a detention basin is not to put infill, but remove settled solids.
Yeah, absolutely.
This is unusual.
Absolutely, but there is an issue here, and it is maintenance to get this thing to work right.
It's not to the plan.
Well, keep in mind, the purpose of this is to detain stormwater, and the lower the elevation, the more stormwater it will detain.
Yeah, but it's not going to emit water the way it was designed.
It's not
It's in a pool, and it stays there. If it was designed correctly, it would drain where that V outlet is.
I'm with you.
I want to need a commitment from George that he's going to take care of this relatively soon.
What do you mean?
Well,
take care of
or
what?
Before he leaves.
He's not doing the work.
he is retiring.
Isn't he
not?
That it gets
the process.
Done. That it gets, you know,
okay.
That it
you're
gets.
Paying for this.
He's retiring in June.
No.
And
not to my knowledge.
Who's paying for this?
There's a bond, and the money would come out of the bond.
Mm-hmm.
Is the bond sufficient to cover this?
Good question.
From what I'm told, George believes so, but that's why he was going to go back to Mr. Couliard and ask the question if he wants to take it out of the bond, or if Mr. Couliard wants to come back and do the work.
Okay.
So that was the question that was up in the air at the beginning of the month, so I went to him the beginning of the month around January 4th when I came to visit you to try to make the 13th meeting, and then George was going to get back to me. He was busy, so I was just waiting on his reply, and I said, if you can reply to me or Chuck. So I know that he was trying to reply. He has not yet. So we got to this meeting, and I wanted to make sure that was on the docket and we're moving forward.
Okay, it almost sounds like it's barely a conservation issue.
I don't
know. Well, it needs to be.
It's within 100
yeah.
feet.
It's within right. 100 feet.
Well, the reason it's a conservation issue is that we issued an order of condition for this whole development with the condition that this detention basin be in place and work correctly.
Correct.
And it is in place, and whether it's not it working correctly, it's not working as designed. I think we can agree on that. That's why we're involved.
But I think for this particular lot, wasn't a certificate of compliance issued?
Yes. For the whole lot,
for the whole subdivision.
Mm-hmm.
But we just hadn't released the bond.
That's not our bond. The way the commission wanted to handle this particular lot was there was so much money being held, which Mr. Couliard made this argument, there's so much money being held by the engineering department that he didn't think we needed to, he didn't have a bond with the conservation commission. So you asked me to ask the engineering department if we could sister up to their bond and be part of that, and they would kind of watch over us.
Okay.
Well, that kind of worked out until we wanted stuff and they were really ready to give it all back.
Okay,
so that's why we never do that anymore.
Okay.
So, but Mr. Couliard made that point where he had like $300,000-$400,000 bond, something like that. I don't know what it was.
Okay.
And it seemed sensible, but you know, you kind of only take care of your own family at the end of the day, and that's what George and the engineering department did. And we were left out in the cold. Al also owes us a tree at this project.
Correct.
Okay.
Speaking of take care of your own family, if you look at that picture and then you go by and look at the detention basins at Reading Commons, which is the art stone there off West Street, and you go by and look at the detention basin behind the assisted care living off Main Street, there's a world of difference. Those have wetland vegetation in there. They trap the sediments, they provide habitat, and they have places for birds to sit up there and eat the insects that come off of, as opposed to this. So as we require future detention basins, let's have a discussion whether or not we want something like this or something like this other two. Also, with that wetland vegetation, as Mother Nature designed, all those wetland plants have a huge evapotranspiration rate. So they just take that storm water and it gets used rather than rushing down the stream. So let's just have that discussion next time.
Yeah.
Well, I think part of the planning for this particular project, there was a large discussion about turning this into a wetland, you know, a functioning wetland detention basin.
Remember Tom?
This was Tom's
thing.
And I think it became George Zamboris telling, I remember him saying to me, no, this is an engineering detention basin and the town of Reading will maintain its detention basins.
And we see what happened.
Oh, well.
And we told them that.
Well, see what happened or was it just not built?
Well, you see, here we are looking at a detention basin on a plan. Everyone's thinking it's going to get filled in. This isn't even two. There's not even 2 foot separation from the water here, and that's really what
from
the problem. Yeah, that's
right.
Really what
right.
the problem is.
Right.
So that's
right.
why it gets mucky and
right.
it fills up and things stay there. You know, we're just going to put some soil on top of it, and I understand what's happening, but I don't think anyone during that process thought that this wasn't going to be filled with wetland plants after a while.
Right.
So I think there was a discussion between the builder and the owner to say, yeah, you got this thing in your backyard, but just mow it and you got like this lowered ball field or something like that and you can play in it.
Well, as you had visited yesterday, we're a hockey family, so you see the rink that I have out there, right? So that's what his thing was to me. So no, it's just a dry basin and then you can just plug that up and you can fill it with water and you can have your own rink. I said, oh, okay. That's not going to work, Al. But and there's not, again, I'm not a botanist or anything, but there's no vegetation that I know of wetland plants right in that area. There probably is, though. I'm just saying, to my limited knowledge, it's grass that I cut or whatever
right.
it is.
No, it probably
absolutely.
Is grass, but
yeah.
but the thing is, the plants will go to the seeds.
Yep, gotcha.
Will migrate from the wetlands that are there. And
gotcha, okay. So
starts,
that, would that, that in essence could become a wetlands
absolutely.
At some
right.
point.
It could.
So, but it's
it
not today, right?
That's
look,
right.
Look at any.
Okay.
No. That can't.
Juan
that actually
Street,
can't become a
jungle.
Wetlands under the new regs.
Part say there. Again.
This can't.
That won't become a new wetlands under the
not
new regs.
Not a jurisdictional
regs.
Wetlands,
jurisdictional
but
wetlands.
But
it'll
be a biological
in function.
Wetland.
Yeah.
It'll grow.
It's not.
Like
yes. It's not jurisdictional.
It could if you just let it do itself, it would become a wetlands at some point.
Yeah.
Right. So if you see that, just the when you talked about vehicles that got in,
some of it, I don't know, thank God.
That whole lip is crushed stone on. I don't know if you can see it on the. I'm sure you can see it on the. So that's the access road that they had put in for maintenance. But then when I discussed it, that I don't mind maintaining it, in the essence that I can maintain it, you know, don't use any chemicals or anything in that grass area or anything like that, or cut it or anything like that. So that's what I was just doing, cleaning out stuff for the town.
Well, if George's has written a statement that this is okay, that he confirms that once done it meets the original specs, I think I'm okay with it.
Yeah, I don't.
But
well,
I
think weren't we asking for confirmation in writing from George?
So confirmation in writing from George
right.
first, and I think we want an as-built plan after the fact.
Right, with elevation.
With elevation.
Yeah.
And I think that's enough to show that it's actually built in accordance with the plan.
Question on the as-built plan. Who could I use for that? Could I use Jack?
You could use Jack Sullivan.
Yeah, you could use Jack. He's probably a higher surveyor.
Okay. So here's my other question.
But again, if you're not doing the work, it's not you that has to provide the as-built.
Yeah.
Whoever does the work has to do the as-built.
He is doing the work. He's hiring a contractor that's going to pay for the work through Al's bond, the bond that Al has.
Yeah. My question is
Al
to
has
save...
walked away from this project.
Yeah.
Well, wait a minute. You're hiring the contractor and we pay them? We the town?
No. It's the
not,
bond
it's
money.
It's the bond.
It's not the town. It's the bond.
The bond money that was shared between your two departments that you guys will never do again?
It should, yeah, you're right. It should have some sort of town oversight watching it.
I don't think George can release the bond to you. He has to release it to Al once the work is complete. That bond is hell for Al. George can't do with it whatever he wants.
Luckily, that's happening in the engineering department, so however they take care of that, doesn't we can just tell him to go ahead and do it. That paying and the bond is between him, George, and Al. I mean, we're not telling him how to pay for this project. We're just saying, do you need a permit or not?
And the last time I talked to George about it, putting words in our mouths, is that he was going to speak with Mr. Couliard about if Al wanted to do it himself, or if we made the contractor who I would bring in to do the work to the specs that the town wants, gets paid as a vendor through the bond.
So if they made,
I'll talk to George, I guess, about that and try to get clarity.
I guess they would have the contract with his vendor.
So whoever does the as-bills, I'd like to have the town engineering department spot check those as-bills.
I can believe that they'll want to also. When do you think this work would happen?
I would like to do it in the spring, March, April, May.
So George is leaving in June, so it's gonna be a tough time.
Get close.
Yeah, get close. So it's.
I'll expedite the process if you want me to. I mean, I want.
If you want it done.
Of course I do. I start tomorrow. If I get the rest of the snow out there, I'll do it. I mean,
in the spring, that groundwater level is going to be the highest. The groundwater level is going to be very close to where he's filling.
It's going to be difficult to do the work in the spring. It's going to be a mess.
It is.
Be nice to do it.
So it's kind of out of our hands.
But yeah, I mean, that's...
But as far as I know from leaving this meeting right now, I have to get written approval
George.
That we talked with George.
Yep.
One. And after the fact, we're going to find out about payment. And then an as-built.
We need a final
as-built after it's been all done.
With confirmed
heights.
Consistency
heights.
Yep.
That's fine.
And then...
I can send you this list. There's a couple of things that you didn't get.
Well, one of the questions though, that I was asking about trying to not, if there's a limited amount of money in the bond or whatever it is, and try to save money for everybody, is that when I spoke with Jack Flynn about getting some help on the surveying piece, he told me to go to the person who did the
original.
Exactly. Which is through Mr. Couliard.
Phil Christensen.
But I've exhausted efforts trying to get in touch with them and they haven't returned my calls. I don't know why, but then I went back to Mr. Flynn and said, he goes, well, if I got to do it, it's a different price because I had to start from scratch. So he wants to try to talk to that guy for me. So
right.
You'd think Al would want to do this and tap that database because if it comes out of the bond, it's coming out of his pocket.
Right, anyway. Right. It's coming out of his pocket anyway. Well,
so
I'm just doing what I got to do right now, but I'm satisfying what I need with you guys for right this moment.
Yeah.
And if anything happens, Chuck will.
Yeah.
I'll just
ask you to, obviously I'll send you a whole list of things that we want, and it'll include letting us know when it's happening, letting us look at it after it's done.
Yeah, of course,
All that.
Yep, you'll have all the access you want. I'll try to hit George up tomorrow at some point.
I'd be relentless with George. Everyone has some project George has to finish before he leaves.
Sure.
So,
sure, mine is not going to be on top of the list.
No, so
but
make it
okay.
On top of the
list. I'll try. Okay. Is there anything else you need from me?
No.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate all the help from everyone.
Right.
I appreciate it. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Do we have anything else on the agenda that we need to talk about? No? So we already discussed those. We don't have any.
Do we have...
We're going to scroll out dates for the...
do we have minutes?
Stop talking about me. I'm back. Okay. I stole your...
Do we have minutes?
The metrics,
really?
You know what I mean?
Nope.
Okay, thank you very
no
much.
No minutes. Okay.
We did North Reading. DEIR.
Do you know when we're going to see those?
Probably by the weekend.
Okay.
Can we have a
30-second summary of what this tree policy is, or where we're going with it, or what we're doing?
I'd be happy to speak to that. We were not able to meet.
I wasn't here at all. Could you start a little farther back?
I'll try, and we don't have minutes, so. There were two permits that came up at the previous meeting, one of which was continued. It was the first hearing for tonight about trees, and which, you know, basically applicants coming before us with the number of trees they want to cut, and with some rationale, but not necessarily a technical justification for why all these old growth, relative possibly healthy trees need to come down. There was some public comment to the Conservation Commission that, from somebody in the audience's standpoint, it looked like our decision process on cutting trees was looking arbitrary and difficult to understand. And so after our hearings were done during the previous meeting, we discussed a little bit ways to start addressing that, the concern, and possibly move forward towards some sort of policy. So I volunteered to be part of that, and so did Mr. Couillard. And we made plans to meet last week, whenever the big power out was, and the big power out came, and we were supposed to meet that evening around 7, and we decided with the power out wasn't going to happen, and we tried to reschedule, and the last word I had from him was he was in Florida, was hoping to look it over and
was that
get
the background
the phone,
you? I just have to ask.
Get on the phone
background
with me
you wanted.
This week.
That was a lot of background.
I'm not really concise.
Chuck also put together some.
I thought I explained it pretty well.
A one page.
You've just been confronted on my email. I thought I explained it pretty well. Every project has trees that have to take down. We want to be consistent. It was brought to our attention through Mary Ann O'Neill.
Mary Ellen O'Neill.
And it seemed like something where we had two interested commission members would take a stab at putting something together so we could be more consistent. Now, after the meeting, without anyone asking me, I just threw some language together and I put that chart together. That chart is for you to modify. That's why it's in Word format. And if you think there's too many trees, the less trees do all that, but it seems like if we had a chart, it would work out. Now, if you come back and say, look, we don't need a chart, we just need a policy, it's up to you. You're going to get something rough to bring to the commission so we don't have to be mired in this discussion.
Jamie, one of the things we saw, you know, if somebody's removing, is it always a one-for-one replacement?
Right.
What's the size? What's the and getting consistent on that? I think there's
excellent
something.
And can you switch out with shrubs?
Yes.
Yeah.
And other towns have, you know, Chuck forwarded me a lot of information, and other towns have done a lot of work developing their own policies, and you know, so there's a lot of available work out there to beg, borrow, and steal.
Now, I think, and we need to check with Laura, I think that's who we check it with, if this is a ad hoc committee of the Conservation Commission appointed by the chair, then their meetings have to be open, they have to notify them, and they have to be minutes produced.
But they weren't appointed by the chair, and they're a working group.
When we did
policy.
The working group to revise the bylaws, we had to go through that process. We had to post the meetings.
I'll ask tomorrow.
We'll have to check.
Yeah.
And if we had just as a history, the working group we had for the bylaws, I'm biased, but I think it was quite successful and had the support of the town and most of the selectmen. And one reason is that we had other than commission members on it. So it wasn't, we had a broader perspective in developing that, that policy. So that's something to think about.
Who else did you have?
Maybe somebody from Forest Committee? Maybe somebody from Trails Committee, but somebody else who knows trees, but we don't just have an incestuous policy at all. And it's, I don't think it's necessary, but I think it gains broader support and will be a better policy.
Just for clarification, I don't know if, you know, these meetings necessarily constitute a deliberative decision process. It's an investigation. It's the start of something. And it's about policy. It's not about regulation or bylaw. So that's a question for Laura, is if we're working on policy, you know, recommended policy documents for us, is that also something that needs to be, you know, fully under this?
And Nick, I'll give an example. The minor projects. We came up with projects that we felt don't really need to come before us at Chuck.
But we did that in an open meeting here. If we have a separate committee to define what minor policies are.
I don't think that committee is deciding the policy. I think that that committee is drafting a start for the rest of the commission to review.
That's the same thing we did with bylaws. The ad hoc committee drafted a proposal that then came before the committee, and the selectmen went into the website to review our minutes from those meetings, and a few were missing, and they called us on us, and Bill and I had to sit and watch the video. We had to do something and recreate those meetings, and we had to post them, or we were in violation of both the meeting laws, and we were letting it. They let us know that and threatened us with all kinds of things.
So Chuck, you'll find
I'll
out.
Work on it. Yeah.
Okay.
See what happens. I'm gonna. Hopefully, it doesn't need to be to that level. I would hope this is just something that can get done instead of involving a lot of people. Maybe you could have a discussion with Bob Keating. You know, maybe that.
You know,
makes
it might, but I, in terms of the town open meeting law and how business is handled within a public body, we may have to go to that. You know,
yeah,
and if we have to, it doesn't have to be. You know, it doesn't have to be cumbersome. It can progress.
I got
to
tell you, this is the craziest town ever. You know, we do things in two other towns that I've been in that doesn't go in this direction every single time. Anytime someone puts their hand up in the air, open meeting law. It's crazy. I know, and I know Laura is very hawkish about the open meeting law, and I think it's half the time it's not really true. It can't be really true because we're doing it somewhere else.
But I've been the other way in Salem, everything.
Oh, yeah.
Everything. And I've been on all kinds of committees, and everything is open meeting and very well advertised in English and Spanish.
No, that's how we do it here.
Right.
Yeah,
it's
so what
that
I'm
way
saying
here.
Is, you're saying your towns that you're familiar with, they don't.
No, they use it. They use this thing called a working group, and the chair of the Arlington Conservation Commission is a lawyer. And so I assume he knows what he's doing. And we've used that forever. He goes, make sure it's a working group. He didn't say it to me on this case, but when we're doing things, because we have a water bodies working group that I'm involved in, and that's, we don't do any of what you're asking for.
But if this is a appointed committee of the Conservation Commission to develop policy, I'm pretty sure that falls under the open meeting law. But we need to check.
And if,
pretty
well,
sure
I don't think
and
they're
if it's the town policy to make sure it's the open meeting, then I think we have to.
Yeah, let's find out. I mean, I guess when in doubt, we'll have an open meeting. Meeting.
Yep. Right.
Okay.
Any other business?
Emergency permit? None.
None.
What about West Street's construction? Do you know how they seem to be you know, they're setting curbing, they're, how's the erosion control going on that project?
Well, they've moved well beyond Summer Street. It still may look a little rough down there, but they've moved well beyond it. All that curbing is in place. So there's not much to look at in that area. The Abbot Jonah goes down and around. Can't think of the name of the street. But they do have a stockpile area on Summer Street, and they have one further down, which I asked them to do some cleanup, but they're on pavement with curbs around it. And again, the way Newport Construction is working with me and with the engineering department, I can speak for me, every time I ask them to do anything, they go right out and do it.
Great.
Well, there's still, every time it rains, there's still that big puddle down in Willow, Summer, West Street. And when the puddle leaves, there's a silt layer across the concrete.
Yeah.
And it all is coming from that little staging area, and they don't have any erosion control in that staging area on the, you know, that little island.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that meeting is every Thursday at 11 o'clock. If the last time I asked them to keep up with that, they did. Now, I haven't seen that puddle. I guess I'm not here when it's raining out, but they're well beyond that area. I don't know what they have in the storm drain, so it's puddling up, but it must be blocked somehow. Because that's just open access right into the stream.
Yeah, it's just a large, high-intensity precipitation events.
Summer Street. So, any other comments? They're, as far as I know, every Friday they're still coming through and cleaning up.
Good.
Anything on the horizon, project-wise?
At the next meeting, you'll have Morton Field and the high school field, those light poles, those will come in. You have a gas project just where Perfecto's is, it's our right-of-way project. And you also have, what's the next one? Oh, is it town? No, I think that might be it. Those two.
Don't forget, we got 4 more weeks, so there'll be a lot more on the agenda for the 24th.
Yeah,
it'll
be a good meeting.
Yeah.
Particularly because it's going to be probably a report as well.
Oh, right.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Everybody drink your coffee before.
Is our consultant submitting electronically so we can get that before the packets?
Well, we can we'll get those right out to you as soon as possible.
I
do have a question, 2 questions now that I just realized to ask you. One is about when the consultant writes his review and we get the plans. People on Randall Road want those quickly. Does the commission want me to hold off on handing those to them until you get your sets?
Yes.
I would like to review.
I thought it was the idea that we would review it before
and provide
comments on the draft. Isn't that in the?
It is, but once I
scope, yeah.
So there has to be. So the policy with the selectmen, when the packet goes out, they just kind of make sure that the selectmen have it in their hands before they give the packet to anyone else in town. So that means if it goes out on Thursday, people can pick it up on Monday. So I can't hold it too long. If I get the plans next week and, you know, whatever he's going to write up on the site, I don't know if I could wait 2 weeks. As a matter of fact, I've been told that, you know, you can't really hold stuff. So I could send that to you guys immediately and wait 3 or 4 days, and then it's available to the public. That's the best I could do.
You won't make copies. You'll have a copy here if they want to come and look at it. Is that correct?
We usually make copies. They go downstairs to the engineering department. I don't know if they charge them or not, and then they make copies. I mean, that's typically what I do. I don't think I'd just change for this one project.
No.
I mean, I think the whole point is you don't want them, you don't want the abutters to review what you haven't seen yet. I mean, that just makes sense. So, again, this is why I just always have to go with Laura, because, you know, usually
sure
once it's
a, on it.
Once you bring it
yeah.
to an open meeting, then it's public document. But in Reading, it's a public document once it gets to us.
As long as he's got draft on it, I think that's
okay.
Does the scope say draft and final? It should.
It should. I believe it does. I believe this.
I know that there was a provision for us to review it.
Yeah.
And make comments, and then they had to he had to address those.
Provide a final
yeah.
version. So.
Do you want draft on the plans too?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll make sure that happens.
Watermark.
The next project that I wanted to talk to you about is Market Basket, the entrance that's finally come in, John Dick. So there's three coming up for our next meeting, plus what we have pushed off. They want to take down those poplar trees inside that stormwater detention area.
The one on the left as you're driving in.
Yes.
Take out the poplars.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And revegetate that because trees don't really work in that area. And they're going to fix up the side, and I saw something on planning where I guess that sign's going to get fixed up somehow, and you know, maybe there's new lighting. So I don't know the extent of this project yet, but they want to bring it in as an RDA.
I don't think that's an RDA.
If they're just taking those volunteer trees that are growing out of the detention basin, I think that is an RDA. It's a maintenance of a, I mean, it's like this. It's maintenance of a detention basin.
This is on the left side or the
left side?
They're going to do both. They're going to do the other
side
too.
What are they going to do on the right?
They're going to cut in enough to have like a nice mowed area. They're going to try to make it look nice, like professional.
Yeah, but what does that
that's
mean?
That's a created wetland in the replication area.
Well, that's
right.
Further down,
that's
but as the entrance as you go in, that's where they're gonna push stuff back, and they're gonna revegetate that, make grass with regular plantings that you might see in a landscape.
Well, that's wetland in there. That's jurisdiction.
They're not going back. They're what if they stay 10 feet away from the edge of the road? Are they still in the wetland?
I can't remember, but that wetland's pretty damn close to the road.
It's
well,
close where the replication
the,
is,
and,
but
the
then
point.
It goes
there's,
in
go
a little
back.
Further.
I'm telling you where the work
yeah.
is. It's in the center. It's on the side, and it's the restoration type project modified to be less, and less, and it's in here as an RDA. Do you think you have enough to, I mean, we obviously have to look at it now, but do you have enough material with an RDA to give a good evaluation and, you know, write a permit with that? Plus, are we going to be able to watch it after the fact? So my question is,
yeah, I go
is this...
points away from Market Basket, that's going to be no problem.
Right, but do you have any authority without,
oh,
a,
so,
not, without a notice
without
of intent?
Without a notice of intent?
Oh, I
right.
see what you mean.
Yeah.
No.
Well, I don't know what they want to do on the right, but on the left, it's what he described to us,
if
which
he's,
is take out those trees that volunteered in after the thing was designed and built. I don't have any problem with that.
I see it as probably very limited. It shouldn't be an RDA for what I heard and saw on the plan, but you guys can look at it and decide for yourself. It is work on both sides.
If they want to come in and talk to us and then decide which they want to do, I'm good with that.
So it
no,
sounds like
they've already submitted it. They've already submitted it.
Do you
it's,
have it in hand?
We haven't. He gave it to me piecemeal. We have it set aside. We don't even have a check for it yet, so I'm not bothering with it until I get a check. So.
Well, we don't know where on the right-hand side, we don't know what the work is from what you're describing, and we don't know where the wetland is. So we can't really make a decision. It sounds to me like a notice of intent to me, because
I just wanted to bring it to your attention.
If they're maintaining the side of the road, they're more than 35 feet from the wetland on the right-hand side. That could be an argument.
I doubt they're more than 35 feet.
We'll see.
All right, so you have some interesting stuff coming up. That's certainly one of them. And again, the wetland line's important. Yeah, it might be further back in that area. I'm not sure.
It kind of peters out towards the main road.
Walker's Brook Drive,
right?
Yep.
Yeah. But near where those poplars are, that wet area goes right underneath the access road.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So there's wetland right there.
But the poplars that they are talking about, I believe,
it's in the detention basin.
It's in growing on the side of the detention basin, and it's not helping the structure of that.
We don't disagree. I'm talking about the other side.
Yeah, I'm talking about the other side. We'll see.
So it'll be a good meeting.
Yep.
We'll have a lot.
Yep.
I think that guy John, is it John?
The wetlands guy?
Yeah, the wetlands
John
guy.
Deck.
John
Deck. Oh, from Hancock. He's going to present this.
Good.
Okay.
I move to adjourn.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
All right. Teflon's terrifying, huh?